Hello, 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 hello. It's the Jinn and Tonic Show. It's 13th of March, 2016. It's 6 p.m. UTC, and that is what we do. On a Sunday evening, we talk about Islam. Now, I am somebody who is a practicing, what would you call this, practicing a, I'm practicing a dragonism. That's right. I'm practicing a dragonism because I am somebody who is an adragonist. In other words, I do not believe in dragons. And it seems that since I'm not a believer in, of, or around dragons, I also need to be practicing adragonism the same way as I'm practicing aracism and aphilatelism. What do you practice if you don't collect stamps? I mean, if you're a philatelist, you collect stamps. If I'm an aphilatelist, I do not collect stamps. So if I practice aphilatelism, what am I practicing? What do I do? How much time does following aphilatelism cost me? Well, anyway, this is stupid, I know. I identify as something that I am not, and that is an atheist, because I do not believe in gods. I don't believe in ghosts or gods or anything supernatural, as long as there is no evidence for it. So I don't. And this is my outlook when looking at Islam. This is not my outlook when looking at life. When I get up in the morning, I don't think to myself, oh goodness, how am I going to get through this day without a god? I don't think about gods. It does not affect me in any way. So it takes up very little of my time. So the thing that I don't need to prove anything. I am sitting calmly waiting, totally passive, not making any claims whatsoever, because I don't claim to know that there are no gods. A lot of people, I hear this lie again and again and again, that people, theists, say atheists make the claim there are no gods. No, that is not true. I am a person, and a person with a lot of different attributes. And as a person, I say there are no gods. But the atheist cannot say this by definition. As an atheist, I believe, and as an atheist, I do not believe. And I don't know, because that would be agnosticism. So the theist makes the claims, the theist has to provide the evidence, and if the theist does not provide the evidence for the existence of any gods, I'm going to stay an atheist, a non-believer. Just the same way as I'm going to remain an adragonist as long as there is no evidence for the existence of dragons. Now what we're doing is we're talking about Islam. Now the first thing that I learned when I started studying Islam is that there is no such thing as Islam. The second thing I learned is there is no such thing as the Muslim. The third thing I learned is it is based on the interpretation of texts. Number one, primary text, Quran. Now, there is not a single sentence that I know of that doesn't need interpretation. So because it needs interpretation, everybody interprets it slightly different, because there's 6,500 sentences in the Quran. So there's different ways of interpreting them. Then you have the secondary text, which is what Islam is actually all about and what makes Islam such a brutal, misogynistic, violent political ideology. And that is the Hadith, and that is the Sunnah in general. And then, of course, you have the Sharia and you have the fatwas. So all that combined is what is making Islam what it is today. It's a political ideology because it tries to install Sharia everywhere for everyone. It's the dominating religion on the planet. That's what it says in the Quran. So there's a goal, which is a caliphate with Sharia for the entire planet. I just had nuts. Something was stuck in my throat. So it means that in the middle, there's a religion, there's a God who's calling the shots. And the rest is then social, political system, ideology and everything, worldview, way of life, everything around, built around this God, where the God determines the different elements. What happens in the Ministry of Interior, what happens in foreign affairs, in justice, finance, war, commerce, and so on and so forth. And if I look at the different states, yes, we have Islamic states, five of them on this planet. We have the Organization of Islamic States with 53 members or 55. It varies a little bit. Yes, those are countries which claim that they are being run by a god. So like the Islamic Republic of Iran has in the constitution, in its preamble, that it is based on a god. And there are no laws that can be passed which contradict the Quran. Now, we already have them because the Sharia already contradicts the Quran. And this is why we are here, because we know the Quran, we know the Hadith, we know all the claims, we know all the Dawah and all the different apologists, all their different claims and all their tricks and everything. And that is what we're trying to do. We're trying to explain this. Now, the way that it normally works is that I give these definitions, and we have a video of the week, misconception of the week, hadith of the week, and then in between we have the different topics which are normally based around different news out of the Islamic world. Except this time, I was actually very lazy. I did not collect any items newsworthy. Well, there are a couple of items which are newsworthy, but I didn't really collect them the way that I normally do. And I think it's unfair to just simply pretend as though I do and quickly look for some, because it's not difficult, you know, looking through Independent and Daily Mirror and CNN and CBS and all these other places, because there's always something going on in the wonderful world of Islam. What I want to talk about today is Reformation. Now, last week there was a, well, they called it a debate, but it wasn't really a debate. iERA hosted an event which was called "Does Islam Require a Reformation?" And they had six people to discuss this and one chairperson. I made a comment on this, and I would love to discuss Reformation with people, and I'm hoping that somebody will come and join him so that we can discuss this, because I'm very interested in what other people say about this. Now, it would be wonderful if there's a Muslim who is listening to this, because normally Muslims don't like calling him because they're afraid that they're going to be humiliated or ridiculed. So, no, today I just want to know, what reformation do people think Islam needs? Now, the way that you do this is you either go to godless.ch, where you can watch the show, and you can type in comments there, and they will update automatically. And this is a very comfortable way of chatting and talking about people. I see that Quarkwick is there. Welcome to Quarkwick, very, very rare guest indeed. He's probably got 10 minutes to kill, so he's quickly going to pop in here. And you can just type things. You can type your opinion, you can type comments, questions, or corrections. Or if you want to, you just go to hangout.godless.ch and you can just come and chat here. And you can make the same thing. You can make suggestions, comments, ask questions, or make corrections, or whatever you want to do. And especially today, since I do want to talk about Reformation, and I'd love to hear what people what their opinion is, what their ideas are, what Islam actually needs. The other way is to go to the Gin and Tonic Show. Now, on YouTube, there is such an animal. Now, I don't qualify for a custom URL yet, so I can't go and ask for Gin and Tonic Show or something. So it's called the Gin and Tonic Show. And a lot of people are used to the new address because the old one was closed down. And unfortunately, and I think I need to refresh this page before anything happens, before I can actually see comments. There are no comments. But it doesn't update automatically. This is the problem with this. In the godless.ch, it updates automatically. I don't need to do anything. Everybody can see who is typing, and then it just rolls over. And this is brilliant. This is something that Ike has set up, and thank you very much. And he's also the one who does the, the Hadith of the Week in the background every single week. So that's also brilliant. Another successful day for that blight on the world, the dysfunctional religion of peace, 11 dead in the Ivory Coast and a bomb in Turkey. Yeah, exactly. You see, it doesn't take a lot. to go and look at the news, and you will find something inevitably about Islam, where people, supporters, followers, believers in the religion of peace will do their thing. And this is exactly why I think there should be a reformation in Islam. Now, the funny thing is, during this this event, this what they call debate, there is one Muslim who is an imam. He's the Dr. Taj Shalge. And we've heard of him before, because I remember on the Jinn&Tonic Show, we've had this thing. I bumped into him a couple of times already, where, for example, in my Islamogetics videos, I once came across some woman who decided to question me. And then I looked at what she has to offer, and she went on a rant describing this Dr. Hage as the devil himself. I looked a little bit at him, and he is the one who has already implemented reform of Islam for himself in his mosque, because he is somebody who has already said, look, I don't care about what kind of a person you are. This is up to you, and this is up to you how you square off with God. I believe that there's a God, and I have a mosque, and I'm an imam. I'm going to lead the prayer. I'm going to do it the way that it is intended in the Quran. I'm not going to go into this routine, this blind following of rituals, the way it is described in Hadith or in the Sunnah or whatever, or how scholars think that God says that you should put your elbows at this angle and your arms either below, on top, or above your belly button when you are praying. He says that's bullshit. You pray how you are comfortable. There is no necessity to pray in Arabic. There are no rituals. You do what you are comfortable with. If you want to follow me, that's cool. But don't expect me to go and follow all the rituals that you will find in various hadiths and in various madhabs. What do you call them? As the regional the regional jurisprudence leaders. Because what Mr. Shafi, Mr. Hanbali, Mr. Hanafi, and so what they said, he says, does not concern me, because this is just a misinterpretation, and this is not the way that we can work on this in the 21st century in the UK. And he says, if I look at Indonesia, Islam has managed to adapt and assimilate according to what the Indonesian requirements are. So the mosques there look more like temples, like Buddhist temples, than the mosque that you see in Riyadh. And he says, this is the success of Islam in Indonesia, where it just adapted to the local culture, and that is it. And so why shouldn't Islam be able to do the same thing in the UK? Why is it that Muslims come to the UK and they expect the culture in the UK to adopt to the culture of 7th century Arabia? He says that is not reasonable. So we should not be a religion of rituals, we should be a religion of understanding. So we should look at what it is that this God wants, and we should look at what this God wants from us. And that is how he sees reform. And that's what he's done. So in his mosque, he says, look, it's not up to me to judge who is a gay. If a gay is a Muslim, and he feels like praying and getting close to God and telling God whatever it is that he wants to tell a God, well, then that is fine. Why should I now go and stone him or kill him because he is gay? It's none of my concern. And if that guy is okay with it between him and his God, that's great. So why should I send somebody home just because they're gay? Or women, why should I put them into a different room? Why should I put a wall between men and women? God created women, and if they created a woman with a beautiful ass and she's in front of me and she's praying and I want to look at her ass, well, then that is my God-given right, because God made me to appreciate the ass in front of me, which he also created. If God had not wanted me to look at that beautiful ass in front of me, he would have made that ass a lot less beautiful, so I wouldn't want to look at it. I mean, that is now logics. That is reasonable. That is thinking. That is looking at reality. And that is not blindly saying, You're not allowed to look at a female ass, so let's move the asses out of the way, and all you're allowed to see is men's asses. If you find those attractive, however, then you've got a problem that we need to kill you. That's stupid. I mean, how can you tell young boys, teenagers, 16, 17, 18-year-olds, I mean, all they want is to have sex. And you tell the girls of the same age, all they want to do is have sex. All they want to do is experiment with each other. All they want to do is socialize. All they want to learn is, how do you handle life with the opposite sex? How do you handle life? How do you get into a social situation, into social interaction with people? And then you tell them, nope, you're not allowed to. You're only allowed to hang out with the boys. The girls are only allowed to hang out with the girls. But you're not allowed to be gay or sex or lesbian. That's stupid. I mean, what do you expect? I mean, like I always say, I've seen it. Okay, I used to love, because there's a shopping center in Doha, for example, which is like a triangle. And if you sit, I used to sit at the head of the triangle, and then I used to spend hours just sipping coffee and eating there and blah, blah. And this was brilliant, because I Thursday evening, for example, you will find that the circumambulation, because the girls are going anti-clockwise and the guys are going clockwise, and then you have groups of three or four, because you're only allowed to go out in groups of girls and groups of guys, so they go this way around, the girls go the other way around, and then when they meet each other, then when they are past each other, it's frantic, you know, on WhatsApp or something, that they're exchanging messages, that did you see him, and then they start giggling. Come on, what do 15-year-old girls do? That is what 15-year-old girls do. And that's normal. That is why Islam needs to reform. You cannot have this segregation. You cannot have this artificial choking of hormones just when they're rampant. You can educate people. You can teach them how to be responsible. You can teach them how, if a guy approaches a girl, not to rape her. Not teach the girls not to get raped, but teach the guys not to rape. So this is the kind of a reform that I would love to see. And this is what this Dr. Taj has already done, where he says, no, if you're a lesbian, if you're a gay, if you are whatever you are, you can come. And he has women leading prayer. So he has female imams. And he says, what's wrong with that? God made them. And it says in the Quran, everybody is equal before God. So it's the same thing, whether you're a man or a woman, for this God, you're the same. Whether you are a degree above or below on earth when it comes to financial matters, that's a totally different issue. That is between you and the people, whether you want to attach this to yourself or whether you say, nah, that's for the 7th century, this is not for me today. So if God had wanted females to be in a different league from a what you want to call it, human rights perspective, then he would have done so. He didn't. Okay, so this is what I think, and I think that there's a lot of issues in Islam, and in this iERA event, does Islam require a reformation? They just said, no, we don't really need this. Islam is fine the way that it is, and they don't realize that Islam is dying. And if they don't do anything, if they don't reform, it is going to continue to die. And that's the end of the story. Now, is it going to be me talking all the time? Or is there going to be somebody who is going to come in here and say, okay, I've got an idea, I've got a contribution, I've got a question, I've got something. Come on, guys. Ah, Jeremy's there. Wow. Alhamdulillah. The thing is that if you want to participate, there's different ways. Let me just repeat this for anybody out there, where you have different ways where you can either go to godless.ch, where you can just listen and then type some comments or something, or you can come straight into the Hangout, hangout.godless.ch, where you can participate here and voice your opinion and ask questions or whatever you want to do. And if you've missed it, you can then go to archive.godless.ch, where you can watch past episodes and then either ask or whatever. Okay, anybody in the chat who wants to say something?
Dragons exist.
Can I not hear something, or is nobody saying something?
I've said something.
There you go. Now I can hear you.
All right. I don't know if you've said this whilst I was waking up, but I think Muslim of the Week has to go to the imam who was murdered in a park. Have you heard the outcome of that?
I have not. I have been active otherwise this week, so I'm a little bit out of it. No, I have not heard about this.
No, it was an interesting story. It happened about 2 or 3 weeks ago, the start of it. An imam, late at night, was walking home from his mosque, and he was murdered in a park. And, of course, the press started off with the Islamophobic chant of people who were doing Muslim revenge attacks.
What is Islamophobic?
Yeah, they were blaming whites or the EDL or anybody for beating up and killing this Muslim, this old man. He was in his 80s, I think he was, something like that. But it transpires he was actually killed by Muslims.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, he was actually heroically standing up against ISIS and trying to persuade youngsters in the mosque not to join, and a couple of ISIS supporters took exception to this and murdered him when on his way home.
Wow.
So I was thinking, certainly a round of applause for a heroic man goes to that imam for standing up for peace and trying to dissuade children from getting killed.
Wow, that is sick. That is sick. Yeah, and this is the thing, what I always say, that people resort to violence if they run out of arguments, if they don't know what they're doing, if they can't really, you know, come to grips with what is happening, then they resort to violence. And this is what happens a lot in Islam, unfortunately. Wow. Now, how did this transpire? How did they find that out? Do you know? Do you have any details on this?
Oh, yes. They arrested two people on suspicion. And the press kept quiet about any details about these people until, like I say, last week, when it turned out they were Muslims.
But you don't know why and how they found this out?
Details about that. Obviously, it's still under investigation.
Wow, that is amazing.
But they released the names, I think, of these two guys and the fact they were Muslims and the fact that they were supporters and what this imam was doing within his church. And put the pieces together.
You know, it's quite sick. Where I know that everybody's always saying, I wish the imams would tell people not to join ISIS, not to join Daesh, not to do this, not to go down the path of violence and blah, blah, blah. And then those people, those reasonable people, they are the ones who get killed. And that's so sad. You know, this is, I don't know, there's no, yeah. The only solution is, again, reform. They need reform. What is your idea? What is your approach or whatever with reformation in Islam?
Mine personally. Well, I thought there was this other chap, I don't know who he is, but on Twitter he was saying that all books of violence should be banned.
Yeah, that's quite a few. I mean, because you've got quite a few Muslims.
He wanted to really ban Donald Trump. But my response was, well, that's the Qur'an ban.
Trump
didn't
is an idiot. I think what he's doing is actually making a joke of this, making a joke of everything that is anti-Islam, where you have people without any basic knowledge who are making comments like that. I mean, and then you have the people, you have the Muslims, who are then saying, well, Trump is saying that all Muslims should be banned. And no, that is not what he's saying. Or people say, God, chuck all Muslims out of America. I said, no, that's not what he said. He just said to temporarily stop all immigration by Muslims into the U.S. That's what he said. So you need to be, you know, like a little bit more precise in what it is that you're actually saying. It's quite funny. Okay, what do you think about Reformation? What do you think? Do you think there should be a Reformation? And if yes, what do you think should be reformed?
Well, I don't know about Reformation either. I mean, I'm trying to look up his name now to try and remind me. But I think if we could tell the Muslims the truth about their religion, there'd probably be enough to make them give it up. There's this Christian chap who you might have heard of who hangs around Hyde Park Corner, the Speaker's Corner. Jay West, I believe it is. Yes, Jay, no, Jay Smith.
Oh, yeah, I know the guy with the white hair, about 60, 70 or something.
Yes, that's the chap. And I was watching one of his debates with this other Islamic scholar. It's listed under a classical debate. But anyway, he's talking about the history of the Quran. And it's incredible how many different versions there are.
Yeah.
And if Muslims were to have it all listed in front of them, how many different Muslim versions there were, and how stupid their comments of how the Quran has never been altered or changed.
Oh, that's stupid. Yeah, you're right.
When you find out that the actual Quran that they have in their paws right now wasn't actually canonized until 1924.
Yeah, the Cairo version. Yeah. But then, what do you say about the contents, or what ideas do you think are the worst?
It's worse on so many levels. It's worse literature. It's worse than unfinished stories. It's
but
worse historical.
Do you think that the Quran should be rewritten from scratch?
I mean, if you were to take everything that wasn't original from it, there'd be very little left.
No, then you just get the narcissistic, you know, self-praise of the God. That's all that's left. The rest is all taken from the Torah and the Bible, yeah.
I mean, apparently there's lots of Christian stuff in it from the Gnostic Christians.
Yeah.
I mean, I was quite surprised how much of it was all fabricated and apocryphized and taken from other sources. It was far more worse than what...
Yeah, but then what you're doing is you're basically blaming now the Jews and the Christians for the brutal, violent, misogynistic contents of the Bibles, which was then transported into the Quran. But the question is, if I look at the Quran, I don't see any coherent structure. I don't see any point where somebody says something in the beginning and somebody says the exact opposite in the middle and then the opposite again at the end. You have internal contradictions all the time. You have different versions which are never finished, and then you have the Moses story repeated like 36 times or something. So my question is whether you need a Quran which says, well, you should pray in the beginning during lunch, and then it says, well, you should pray in the morning, and then, of course, the evening prayer. Then it says, well, later on, well, no, not really. You should look at the morning prayer, and oh, no, not really. It's actually the evening prayer and things like that. Shouldn't you have, like, one concise, structured view of what it is that this God wants?
Well, my honest answer, I suppose, has to go back to my original answer to the question of what do you do with Muslims, and that is nothing. We just have a law, and if they, we just have a law of the land, and if they break it through their act of obedience to their God, they get arrested and punished accordingly, according to the law.
Yeah, but that doesn't help. That doesn't. Okay, what you're doing is you're fighting the symptom, but not the cause, because you need to understand that Muslims are taught that they are the super people.
You can't stop people being stupid.
Yeah, but you can tell. Okay.
You can only stop them and act as a deterrent to their insanity.
And you don't think that a reform within Islam can help, you know, in the guidance process?
Doubt it. I very much doubt it. They'll only find probably another excuse for being an idiot.
And that's true. This is what I found in the iERA event, where this is exactly what they said. It's always the others who are to blame and never Islam. And then a guy actually turns around and says, yeah, but hang on, the question shouldn't be, should there be a reform in Islam, but should there be a reform in Britain that the British accept Islam the way that it is, so that everybody bows down, kneels, and the women get all covered up so that they can go and accept Islam the way that it is. And that's crazy. That's really, it's mad.
You guys hear me?
Yeah.
Talking about the clear message, you know, it's all about the clear message of the Quran. I was listening to a podcast from Sam Harris last night. He just released it, and it was one where he said he didn't want to release it, but a bunch of people had persuaded him to, because he thought it was a really bad quality interview with a guy, his name I can't remember now, but he published a sort of salon article that criticised his Majid Nawaz book. But during that conversation, it's quite long and rambling, but one of the things the guy he was talking to was going on about was how you had like university-educated people who believed in the Quran and people who'd studied it for their whole lives. And there were sort of disagreements about what the message was. And I'm just thinking, well, that just shows how ludicrous it is that God couldn't, if it was written by God, surely he could have written a clear message. Surely you shouldn't need to study it for your whole life and we can't be sure who's got the right interpretation.
Exactly.
It's insane that he thinks that's a point in favor of Islam or something.
Okay, and if you look at it, what would you change about the Quran? Would you rewrite it from scratch?
I don't see any point in rewriting it because that seems to be an acknowledgement that it's worth rewriting. But what Sam Harris was basically saying was the most plausible interpretation is basically ISIS. I think that was what he was saying at one point, which I agree with. And then this guy was saying, yeah, but there are people who've studied it for their whole lives and you can come up with all sorts of different interpretations. But surely if it's this perfect, wonderful book, there should only be... God could write it in such a way there's only one interpretation and it's really clear and anyone can understand it. Well, why would he write it so complicated that no one can really know who's correctly interpreting it?
Exactly. Why should he provide us with signs when he could be very precise and it should be like a legal construct? I want you to fucking pray five times and I don't want you to interpret this exactly. Okay, if you don't want to rewrite the Quran, is there any section in Islam that you would want to see reformed?
That I would want to see reformed?
Yes.
Reformed. No, I think it's beyond reform. I think you've got to do away with it. Sharia is a disaster. The fundamental principle of Sharia is that you can't change it because we figured it all out 1,500 years ago. It needs to be rejected. You can't reform it.
Yeah, but the Sharia is based on the Quran, and the Quran says that you need the Sharia. So, no, actually, the Quran does not say you need Sharia. It just describes it, and then the Hadith say, well, then this is the law of the land, and this is what we are implementing because it's the best law, because it's the one made by a God. So it's also interpretation.
It's like saying the Empire State Building's leaning, we need to fix it. The problem's with the foundations. I mean, how do you fix that? You need to knock the thing down and start again. But what's the point in rebuilding Islam? Because the problem is Islam itself, isn't it?
Okay, but if you take away,
you're going to knock it down, you might as well replace it with atheism or humanism and reason.
Okay, but if you take Islam and you leave the God, but you take out the political aspect, you take out Sharia, exactly what you're saying, and then what you do is you rewrite it in a way that it becomes clear to people that there is no interpretation necessary, that you will say, okay, look, if you want to pray, you can pray whatever you want, however you want, in whatever language, at whatever time of the day, in whatever direction, wearing whatever you want. Then you're done.
That seems to be kind of the approach that Majid Nawaz is encouraging and Ayan Hirsi and all that, going around finding these reformers. But I suppose my question is, which is more likely to succeed, that or just rejecting it altogether?
Well, this is the question. Because the question that I'm now asking, and I was hoping that somebody else was going to come up with this, what is the identity of Islam and how much of this identity are you taking away if you rewrite the Quran? is that still Islam if you take away this concept of interpretation? Is that still then what people would recognize as Islam? Or would you then replace it with clear commands, and then people will say, this is exactly what we need, and this is then what we will identify with over the next 50 years in the form of evolution as a reformation? This is the question. I do not know this.
Well, I suppose one of the first things you would have to get rid of is this mistaken idea that Muhammad is the perfect example. Because too many historical and actual recorded events of him being an absolute nasty.
True.
If you got rid of the person, then you've got an opt to say, well, Sharia could be the best that mankind could democratically agree upon as a way of lifestyle.
Okay, but you need Muhammad to justify slavery, misogyny, and
all that. Yeah, so if you got rid of him as the perfect example, you've then got an option to be able to divert outcomes.
Just tell Christians that Jesus wasn't a particularly important guy. Just ignore that guy, you know. He didn't get resurrected.
No, that's what the Catholic Church did in many ways, didn't they? When they started to absorb land and wealth and power and influence, they were rejecting Jesus' example of giving up everything and going out preaching Christianity and the end of days to the populace. They said,
They never did away with the idea of the resurrection, though. That's fundamental.
But they had the Christianity's resurrection so they could sell indulgences.
But hang on. What Jesus did, he did not behead 800 guys in one day. He did not go and rape a woman just after he had killed her father, brother, and uncle. He didn't do things like that.
Yeah, so you wouldn't want to have that as a perfect example, would you?
And now what I'm getting to is, even though he did not do that, there is no way that people will want to follow him one-on-one today, to run around on sandals throughout Israel or Judea and try and heal people or try and walk on water or do all these things. There is a huge difference between Jesus as a metaphorical and allegorical figure, who is just a symbol of something, and Muhammad. Muhammad is Jesus is the theoretical guy,
You do get Christians who try to perform miracles. You do get Christians who do try to perform miracles, that do try to so-called walk on water. And they...
Well, they're welcome to do so. Is there a victim?
They do try. Watchman Nee. Have you never heard of Watchman Nee?
No.
He's a very famous Christian from China during the early parts of the 1900s, who used to do exactly things like that. You'll find his books printed and freely distributed around the Pentecostal churches, because he would have silly things happen, like his disciples saying to the peasants in a village that their God was so great that he would cause the rain to fall in during a period of a drought. And Watchman Nee was saying, oh my God, what are we going to do? This idiot has just put us in a position where God now has to rain. And he does. God does actually rain.
Okay, but the point that I was trying to make is, if you take the figure, the symbol of Jesus, if somebody tries and follow Jesus, is there a victim?
Well, depends if he was playing alimony.
If he was playing alimony?
Yeah, he'd leave his wife and he'd be without money, and he wouldn't give his wife any money. And the kids would be destitute without any soles or shoes.
Is that what Jesus propagated?
Yeah, he said, leave your wife, just dump her and your children, come follow me.
Oh, okay. All right, that's true. So that also needs a reform. Now, if I ask the same question of Muhammad.
Well, Muhammad came from a different angle to the same problem, didn't he?
This is the point I'm trying to make.
He, like Jesus, the only similarity the two had was Muhammad and Jesus both prophesied the end of days. And Jesus' message was, the end of days is coming, so repent and become the best person you can for God, so that when the end of days happens in our lifetime, you can go to heaven. And Muhammad was saying, the end of days is coming, so let's kill everybody and get rid of all the unworthy ones, so when God arrives, there'll only be us Muslims.
Okay. So how would you go and reform that?
Well, like I said, I'd get rid of that one line about him being the perfect example.
Get rid of Muhammad. Okay.
Oh, you're not got rid of Muhammad. You've still got his sort of like sayings about the five pillars, and you've still got his things about talking camels and milking
camels. Yeah, but fasting,
camels.
I mean, the concept of what Muslims call fasting, I mean, it's not fasting, it's skipping lunch. That doesn't work on this planet. I mean, if you go to Norway, you can't have this.
But he's not a perfect example anymore, is he?
Yeah, but the thing is that Islam, with the rituals, does not work at all.
Well, that's just a mere inconvenience.
So I would say do away with all the rituals. Do away with all these prescriptions that you get in the Hadith regarding all the rituals that you need to run around the Kaaba seven times anti-clockwise. I mean, what is that in aid of?
The Hadith was only written because Muhammad was the perfect example, so all his fanboys wanted to know what Muhammad's example was.
Okay, so you would do away with Muhammad being an idol.
Yeah, and then the Hadiths would become unimportant.
And then you would do away with the Hadiths?
Wouldn't have to. They become unimportant. They just become like a fan club memoir.
Well, if you take away Muhammad, then the Hadiths are useless because they're based on Muhammad, so they become obsolete immediately.
Yeah, is it the Shiites who don't particularly pay attention to the Hadiths?
No, they have their own set of the traditions. They have very similar traditions.
But they're becoming like the Sufi atheists, so sort of like say, oh, monkeys to Muhammad, and let's just all have a good time trying to become like God spiritually.
Okay, and going into deep meditation, yeah.
And trances and magic trance, mushroom type things.
Okay, but I'm still trying to find out what other ideas people have, because for me, the number one driver of reform in Islam is human rights. Because for me, it's absolutely it's a knockout criteria. If a God were to come to me and say, you need to treat women differently than men, and you need to treat a different group of people differently just because they are a different group of people with a different kind of belief. So that would, for me, would be a complete no-no. Don't take Christians as friends. Don't take Jews as friends. And Jews be ye apes despised. I mean, that for me is crazy. So these things need to go immediately. And then, of course, everything, all these barbaric customs that you have with cutting off feet and hands on opposite sides and crucifixion and all these other hacking off a hand, that doesn't belong in the 21st century. So those are the first things that I would reform. If somebody were to say to me, okay, look, we're trying to put together a panel of people who can make suggestions on how to reform Islam without doing away with Islam. These are the things that I would suggest, human rights. That's the first thing. But the question is, how much of the identity of Islam am I forfeiting if I get rid of the restrictions of the human rights and if I make women equal and I do away with all the barbaric kind of punishment? Hey, welcome, Abu. What is your take on reformation in Islam? What would you reform first of all if you were given the chance? Abu is not talking to us today. Ike, do you have a suggestion? Come on, guys, don't let me do all the talking here alone.
Well, put pen and paper in the Kabul and ask God to write it again.
Yeah, but the thing is, what do we need a Quran version 2, or do we need to get rid of Islam, or is there a way to salvage Islam just with a couple of minor amendments?
It'll be version 23, I think, wouldn't it? See, they started off with 7, then they became 4, and then they got rid of all of those.
So no, there's actually 30. 14. There's 30 different versions.
Okay, so what's wrong with version 31?
Then we do 31.
Yeah.
Okay, it doesn't matter what version number I do. I just gave it version 2 because Quran 1 or whatever. That's my question. What is the thing that people would reform with what outcome? Like, you're an atheist, what am I doing here? It must be the wrong planet or show or something. I would do anything, I would not be an atheist. What?
Well, put a mention in for dogs. I don't think dogs and pigs should be so badly treated. I mean, we want to keep the people in PETA happy.
So what, you scratch all animals?
No, no, don't scratch them all. I mean,
no, from out of the religious scripture, I mean.
Well, we know Mohammed liked his pussies, but I think he should like his doggies too.
Yeah, but his piggies. Does he really like the pussies? Because I know that the story with him going to prayer and then he cut a piece off of his garment because a cat was lying on, that's fabricated.
Yeah, he wanted to kill all cats and dogs because he said they shouldn't be sold.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's in a hadith somewhere.
TJ, welcome. What would you reform in Islam if given the opportunity to sit on a panel?
Where do I begin? The absolute first thing, the concept of jihad fi sabilillah, or as I say, jihad in the path of God. Or on jihad.
A misunderstanding. Okay, so you would define it and you would specify it.
Yeah, I mean, jihad in the path of Allah, which basically means to overthrow the government at the time and install Sharia in its place. So, basically, the Islamic revolution, if you will, that concept, which is part of armed jihad, I would say would be the first thing. If you don't abrogate that first, then
what would you put instead? Or just leave it out and leave it as a spiritual reminder?
I would get rid of it altogether. You can have your internal jihad if you want to, but externally it should be abrogated.
And call it something else so that we don't have this misconception any longer.
Exactly. That's the first thing. And then second thing, definitely treatment of non-Muslims. Having them in like a third-class status.
The dhimmi status.
Yeah. I mean, Muslim men are obviously first-class citizens, then Muslim women, and then non-Muslims, so basically third-class citizens. So, no freedom of thought there, no freedom of conscience, get rid of the apostasy laws, open criticism. I mean, there's so many things.
Hang on, what apostasy laws?
In the Sharia. Apostasy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Based off of the Hadith, Muhammad says that whoever leaves the religion, kill him. So,
okay.
Even though he says it like 5 other times, I think, in Hadith, so you have to get rid of that as well. But, I mean, there's so many things. It can't be reformed, truth be told. I mean, in all, like, we can either live idealistically or, realistically. So, realistically, it's not possible. I would prefer people just to leave. I mean, I don't care if they choose Christianity, atheism, Zoroastrianism, Buddhism. I wouldn't care, as long as they left. And people are leaving now in droves. So.
Yeah. So, well, exactly. So what you are saying is, leave everything as is, and it's going to go extinct on its own.
I mean, just like communism. Yeah. I mean, there's still. I mean, communism is still around, but it'll be reduced, I think, to a substantial point. So.
That's an interesting question, actually. I mean, where are the stats that it's that people are leaving in droves?
I think I saw a channel recently. I'll look it up, but this person on the channel was saying like 75% of converts leave or something like that.
That's a study by Dr. Abjunus, where within the first 6 years, 75% of all converts leave. And the leading in droves is that there are articles everywhere where people in Russia, for example, in Indonesia, in all sorts of places, they are leaving by the millions.
Yeah, but they still have to keep
quiet. There's a difference between a convert and someone who's been brought up with Islam.
Sorry, did you understand that? He was brought up by Islam?
No, he said that there's a difference between converts to Islam and people that are born into it.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, so, which is true, but I feel like the tide is turning, and like, we have to take Islam seriously. I mean, enough with Christianity, enough with Judaism. They're not killing people or chopping people's heads off or throwing great, you know, gays off buildings or anything like that. I think it's time, like, you know, that Islam, you know, deserves to be scrutinized, deserves to be critiqued, deserves to be challenged. You know, I'm tired of the atheist community still picking on Christianity and Judaism. That's been done and over with. You know, we need to start criticizing Islam. This is the monotheism that's causing the most amount of chaos and carnage in the world.
Okay, but then why are there so many channels still talking about Christianity, and why
because
are there
they're so pussies.
Many people
because they're
watching
pussies.
This?
Because they're pussies. That's why they have no balls. Or they think that criticizing Islam is racist, which means that they're part of the regressive left.
Because what is funny, because Aaron, is everybody aware who Aaron Ra is?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yep.
Okay. Aaron has had some interviews, and he was talking about Islam, and I contacted him and I said, listen, don't you want to do a session on Islam? Because there's a lot of misconceptions out there that you are talking about. And he immediately jumped and said, oh, that will be excellent. Yes, let's do it. The only thing is, he then asked around and then suddenly said, no, I'm not interested. And suddenly he pulled back and he says, no, I'm not going to do it. Now, apparently, he's going to be in the neighborhood next week, and he said, let's do it in person. Let's talk about this. Let's see what it is that you can bring to the table, because he's poop scared of doing the wrong thing. And I said, it's a pity that you are now drawing back, that you don't trust me sufficiently to know that I'm going to do it in a very respectful, in a very normal and fact-based manner, without putting you into a predicament that you are being the asshole. But apparently that's the way that it is. He is exactly what you are scared, what you're saying. He's scared of somehow damaging his reputation by talking about Islam, especially to somebody like me.
It shows that he's part of the regressive left. Case in point.
Well, anyway, I'll see if he comes back to, because he said he's going to contact me when he's going to be here. And he hasn't
yet. I think
it would
probably be more to do with the fact you don't have any letters after your name to back up your statements.
Yeah, I need, what's this guy's name? Jerzy Aslan. Now, what's Aslan's name?
Reza. Reza Aslan has letters and gets onto TV.
PhD, PhD, MSc, and so on, yeah.
Yeah, but with Aaron Ra and his attacks against Christianity, he is doing it because Christianity really is his enemy in Texas, whereas Islam might have sent a few lone gunmen running into talks by Robert Spencer. He has to fight the Christians who are trying to change the educational system of
True.
The children in America. And that is why Richard Dawkins started up his foundation in America rather than England, but for the discounts he gets for forming up a charity, it's easier. But America has a real fundamentalist Christian problem. About 20 to 30 years ago, something like 80% of Americans were notifying themselves as Christians. It's a lot lower now, but it's only through the actions of people like Dawkins trying to challenge the Christians at every level, who were trying to put things like the Ten Commandments in public buildings and crucifixes in every single school and people having to say pledging their allegiance to country and to God. If it wasn't for Dawkins' foundation and his rolling in of people like Kitchens et al. To argue their case, Christianity would still be a mighty force in America, dictating politics on a level far greater than it does now.
Yeah, but the last thing that Dawkins has made, done, attached, addressed, or whatever, Islam, is when he was interviewing those four girls in a school.
Yeah, he has done other things, but Dawkins is quite literally when he says, I don't attack Islam very much because I don't know much about it.
Yeah, I suppose that's it.
But that's why Hitchens turned and started to attack and Sam Harris, because remember, it's the four horsemen were more of a team, each focusing in their own little niches. Sam Harris, when he started, was mostly against Christians, letters to a Christian nation. Now he's mostly against Islam, because like Hitchens, he decided all religions are bad, but at this time, Islam is probably by far the most dangerous.
Yeah, that's what TJ just said, exactly. Abu, is your microphone in now?
Yes.
Oh, brilliant. So what would you like to see changed, reformed, or modified, amended in Islam?
I don't know, really. I think I'm not that into the reform. I'm more into people realizing that it ain't true. But I think you were talking about inviting people before, or is that correct?
Yes.
I mean, do you know God Saad?
Yes. Professor Saad, yes.
I think he is one of the guys. He's quite generous.
I think he's ex-Muslim, isn't he?
No, he's Jewish.
Oh, really? I thought he was, because he knows a huge amount about Islam.
Yeah, he was born in Lebanon.
From Lebanon?
Yeah, exactly. But there are many people, like, if you've seen, like, the Rubin Report and Gadsad's channel, you can, like, invite the people that, like, Gadsad, and what's, there's a...
Yeah, but he invites people over to him, or maybe I should apply for him.
No, but, like, my picture of him is that he's kind of, if you send him a message, he probably will answer you. So he's a generous guy.
So maybe I should invite him to the Jinn&Tonic Show and make it about Reformation and then discuss with him what he thinks should be reformed.
I think you should invite him. He's an interesting guy.
Yeah, but then I need a topic. I mean, I can't just invite him and say, pull in, cousin, just let's just chat a bit.
Yeah, but he's an evolutionary psychologist. So you can have, maybe we can have a topic. Can you explain Islam from an evolutionary psychological point of view, or anything, I don't know, but it would just be cool.
It's a psychological illness where you need therapy.
No, like he explained it, what's the evolutionary basis for religious beliefs and so on. I don't know, anything. But anyway, I think we should invite more guys like him.
Do you know how many people I invite? I write so many invitations, and people are just simply not interested. A lot of people are scared of Islam because they don't know how to bring it across. They don't know how to say things so that they cannot be taken in the wrong way. Because Sam Harris will just go and say, I mean, he is a miracle, all right? This guy can formulate where you can take a sentence and you can print it. You don't need to review it, you don't need to edit it, you don't need to do anything. You take the sentence and you print it right there and then. But there are very few people who can do that.
Yeah, but Sam Harris is too hard, he's too busy. But Gad Saad, I think it's more realistic.
Sam Harris was actually saying exactly that one. You know, in the podcast I was talking about earlier.
Okay.
He was actually saying, you know, the vast majority of people he knows, they won't touch Islam with a barge pole because, you know, it's too risky for their security. And because they came onto the topic because the guy he was interviewing accused him of writing the book with Brigitte Noir as a get-rich-quick scheme. And he was saying, oh, well, this is like the worst way I could get rich quick. I haven't made much money out of it at all. And he said, I think it's important to raise, but the large majority of people he knows won't talk about Islam because of the heightened risk to their security and it's not profitable or anything like that.
But I've got no real reason
to do it.
Can anyone translate that? Because I only caught like every eighth word.
That's how it sounds like when you're driving on the left side.
Yeah. Can you move the steering wheel to the left, and then maybe we could understand you better? Now, did somebody understand more of it? Because I just heard that he said that
Sam Harris doesn't make much money out of all of his interviews, so he isn't in it for the money. And he's saying that he doesn't get many people supporting him and coming public against Islam because they're scared.
Well, he's right, but I cannot imagine that he's not made a lot of money with this. He should be a multimillionaire. Come on. I mean, I don't know how much he charges as a speaker, but it must be a fortune. I mean, he must be well into the 20,000s per speech.
That's nothing. It's peanuts. That's what you give as a discount.
$20,000?
Yeah, that, that feminist woman.
Dawkins was up to 50.
That feminist woman who's got onto the Twitter panel, she charges something like 200 per speech.
Rebecca Watson?
No, the other one.
Anita Sarkeesian, you mean?
Yeah.
Can you hear me better when I speak like this?
I can hear you.
It's just easier to hear. I can't tell where the microphone is. Yes, I think she charges 20,000 per speech.
No, that was the discount she gave to the university. She said she'd only charged them 20,000 when it went public. Her normal charging is 200.
With regards to Sam Harris, though, in this interview, which is probably worth listening to, he said it wasn't very good, and I can see why he'd say that, because he got angry in it quite a bit. But I actually found it quite entertaining. But the point he was making was he makes very little money out of, like, criticising Islam. It's like the least lucrative thing that he does. That's what he was basically saying, anyway.
Oh, okay, because with his books he must be making a lot, because, I mean, that guy is so brilliant.
Yeah, but he was saying that the Majid Nawaz one is just the most recent book, and his previous books were more profitable. So it's not a get-rich-quick scheme, is what he was saying. Because that's what he was accused of by the Salon article.
Okay, because I see that the people criticizing Christianity are doing a lot better than anyone who is doing Islam. So it seems to be a more rewarding topic for people.
I think he has a salary as a researcher also. So at least when he's doing research. So it's not only... I think he will survive, I think.
I think so, too.
But it's just that he's so busy. But you can try. You can try to... but, I mean, you can... I think it's quite realistic to get guys like Gadsad, and... There's a Pakistani woman, quite young. She was on the Rubin report also.
We've had her.
You already had her. Okay. Yeah, but there are plenty of people you can try.
Well, anyone that I know, I will try. So I'll write to them, blah, 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 can you come on, blah, blah, blah. But other than Hina, nobody has. So, because, I mean, let's face it, Jinn&Tonic Show, everybody says, yeah, we need a Jinn&Tonic Show. But nobody has the time to come and watch it. Nobody has a topic that they would like to see addressed. This is just something that came up now, which is not driven by me. That is iERA, who came up with the topic of Reformation, because they put it into their funny don't hate debate format, which I think was absolutely ludicrous. But then that's the way it goes. And I thought, okay, let's see what others think. But it seems that we all agree. Now, we disagree, because some people are saying, no, let it go extinct, and others say, well, there is something that you can still do with it. I don't know if we can let Islam go away. What are people going to do in Bangladesh, for example? This is their world. This is their life. How can you have Pakistan without Islam?
The other thing that Sam Harris was saying was that Islam was probably the most boring thing his audience to hear about. Like, his audience wanted him to deal with anything other than Islam, because they're so sick of hearing about it by now. I don't know how true that, I don't know how right he is about that.
Well, it is boring to a certain extent if you can't come up with sensationalist topics. I've been to a lecture now on Islam and the role of women on Islam, and this was with some examples, and this is what kept it alive. But then this was over after like 45, 50 minutes, and then people were more interested when I told them, well, this is what I saw when I lived there. This is my personal experience. This is what women do. This is what my wife experienced when she went to the hairdresser. This is, the personal experience. This is something that people enjoy hearing about. But the theoretical part of Islam, I think people are not really that much into it.
Well, it's also the problem of what is actually going on in the news at the moment. For example, in Germany, what are the two big topics about Islam right now and Germany? One might be the fact that Angela Merkel took a German flag off one of her ministers and quickly pushed it off stage, making you question her feelings towards Germany.
No. That's a different background. The problem is that there is a company called AfD, which is the alternative for Germany, and this company is trying to propagate more right-wing attitudes. And what they are doing is they're propagating the German flag as the patriotic value. So what she tried to do is not make it look like the minister is doing the same thing and running as a patriot.
Yeah, well, there you go. Angela Merkel isn't a patriot.
No, because it's exactly right-wing.
Or the second story is what the map, the Google map, which has highlighted all the crimes and rapes and molestations that have gone on in Germany.
Oh, really?
And that's been uploaded.
I haven't seen that.
Yeah, I'm trying to find a link of it on Twitter. But
what is happening in Germany?
I first came across it on the Atheism is Unstoppable original channel, where he does a 20-minute rant about it, and he puts...
I thought you might say that. He's supporting Hillary. Can anyone explain that to me? Why? I asked him this. He hasn't responded. What does he think Hillary's immigration policy would be?
He's probably banned you. I asked him, and he hasn't responded.
I don't think he's banned me on that channel. But the only candidate who's going to have a sensible immigration policy on Islam is Trump, and he's supporting Hillary Clinton. God only knows why. No one seems to have any idea why he thinks Clinton's worth supporting.
Oh, because she's part of the establishment and he loves the establishment, he said.
And then you compare Trump with the flip side on that particular issue, which is Bernie Sanders running an ad in Arabic.
He won't vote for anybody in the GOP.
He ran an ad in Arabic decrying attacks on Islam. He's a bit like Jeremy Corbyn over the UK. Just completely kowtowing to Islam. He's never going to criticise it. He's never going to have a sensible immigration policy he's one of these new liberals who says the immigration policy has to say everyone is allowed in. We can never discriminate against anyone, or that's somehow racist or something.
Well, do you know what Hillary Clinton's policy is on Islam?
I bet penny to a pound that it's something along the lines of we have to respect Islam and it's
she's a
religion of peace and it's one.
She's a war hawk.
Yeah, she might be a war hawk when it comes to the Middle East. Yes, yeah, but when it comes to Islam in general, she's going to say it's a religion of peace. She's not really going to acknowledge the hundreds of millions of Muslims who buy into sort of what we would call extreme, but I suppose I'd just say fundamental Islam that can't stand liberal democracy. She's not going to acknowledge that, is she?
I should probably say they all do.
I don't think it's like he thinks that she's perfect. I think it's more like she's the least bad option, and she will make the least insane decisions.
Yeah, but she's taken millions of dollars from Saudi Arabia, and she claims to support, women's rights. I mean, how bullshit is that?
No, I'm not saying that. I mean, I think I don't have the feeling that she's very genuine.
Yeah, but, well, even then, that's a problem with, like, the left. I mean, they like, you know, atheism is unstoppable makes some great videos, and for the life of me, like, I think it's just the whole concept of idealism, that if we somehow get rid of religion, if we somehow get rid of certain aspects of human society, then some sort of, utopia is going to come. The utopia is an illusion. And I don't understand why people still believe in this, idealistic crap. Like, it just boggles my mind.
You know what I think? I think Hillary Clinton, her primary incentive, I think, is her own career. That's what she cares about. And I don't think she, like, I think he has things that she will be the least, she will make the least insane options. And she, if we have some serious situation, she's probably going to do a lot more than Bernie Sanders. And he thinks that if Trump gets elected, like, really dangerous things can happen and so on.
I understand. Name one dangerous thing.
I'm not saying that that's correct. I'm just trying to explain how.
The really frustrating thing about it is, how do you get a sensible immigration policy anywhere, but in America, for the sake of argument? Because Trump was asked again, does he stand by his comments about blocking Islamic immigration? And he was saying there's a lot of hate out there from the Muslim world. Well, he's 100% correct in saying that. But then people come out in Chicago and riot to stop him giving a rally, and all of the other Republican candidates say, oh, words have consequences. Well, it sounds pretty un-American to me to be so anti-free speech that, oh yeah, well, it's understandable that people would physically try and stop you from speaking because you said something they disagree with politically. So how on earth are you supposed to advance a sensible immigration policy? Or anything other than a free-for-all?
Yeah, well, that's the problem with liberalism, because they see themselves as having the moral, the moral high ground. When they don't, they just have empty rhetoric. They just have these, convictions and these emotions, and they don't rely on facts. They don't rely on empirical data.
It's not just the Muslims. I think most of the people doing this rioting are just going to be left-wingers, aren't they? Social justice warriors.
Exactly. SJWs, feminists, socialists, communists, they all have a shared goal in mind, which is the destruction of the Western world. Shake it to its ground, destroy it, and then start from fresh. It's sickening. Absolutely sickening. And now we have a democratic socialist who's actually running for president. And how many people has socialism killed? I mean, unfucking believable. Pisses me off, the state of this country. It's just going to get worse, I feel like. I mean, now the tide is turning because the silent majority is finally now speaking out. But, look at the Black Lives Matter and feminism, socialism, communism. This stuff is still around. It's a freaking disease of the mind. I don't know why people still believe in this shit. It just boggles my mind.
True that, yeah. Any other opinions on this? What we should do, and what is possible, and what can be done about Islam and integrating it into the 21st century? Because I think this is the main topic, I think, and this is the main problem that I think we have.
Have a proper vetting process.
Of what?
Muslim immigrants coming in. Ask them.
Ah, the immigration. Okay, yeah. So the people.
Yes.
Yeah, so but you ask can't them. See. Yeah, but how do you vet people? You can't say, okay, are you a Muslim? Are you prepared to eat a slice of schnitzel or something?
No. Ask them, or ask any sort of immigrants coming in. How do you feel about women? How do you feel about gays? What are your thoughts on theocracy? What are your thoughts on secularism? What are your thoughts on people leaving a certain religion? What do you think about people who hold different opinions than you, et cetera, et cetera?
And if they lie?
Well, I don't see, and that, that becomes the problem is how are you going to assess the sincerity of their beliefs? I think that's the ultimate issue. How are you going to? I don't know. It's a tough thing. It really is. But first things first, you have to have a process. instead of people just hopping over the border and taking you know free benefits. You know, who said it? Was it Hillary that said that the immigrants, they cross the border because out of love or some shit like that? They just want the benefits. Just like these migrants coming into Europe, all they want is the benefits. The majority of them are not refugees.
What they're told. You see, this is the problem, because in Islam you are being told to obey. You are being told to just simply accept what you are being told. Now they're being told, well, go to Europe, you'll get a mansion, you'll get a lot of money, you'll get a life in luxury, and you don't really need to work. You just need to go to the office a couple of times and that's it. And they believe it, because this is how they were brought up. They were brought up to trust and believe and obey. And now that's what they do. And that is the downfall, because now they suddenly come here, and we've got a lot of people, like I said last week, people are going back home. Because they can't handle Germany, because they find out, no, we are in cramped quarters in some gym somewhere, and it stinks, and it's this. Yes, we are safe, but we don't get as much money. They give us these funny coupons, and all we get for that is some food. But we're not really rich. We're not getting a mansion. We're not getting what we were told we would get, because they're gullible. So,
well, yeah, because they
because the people.
Because they come from slave states, where, you know, where they expect the state to do everything for them.
Yes.
I mean, Germany just banned pork sausages, like, you know, their national food. They banned it from cafeterias because they might offend them.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Sweden, a bishop in Sweden said, we should take off the crosses, you know, from our churches, so, you know, they'll feel more, you know, more welcome. Like, what the fuck? I'm not offended by a cross. Are you fucking serious?
That bishop in Sweden looked like she wasn't even a Christian. I mean, it's just kind of like the most watered down Christianity. You know, the kind
and
of
now, says, I'm a Christian. And now in Sweden, exactly. And now in Sweden, there's a patrol called the Soldiers of Odin, who are going to prevent, you know, migrants from raping. And now the Muslims have set up. Yeah, and now the Muslims have set up Soldiers of Allah.
Oh goodness, that's nice. Let me just find this diagram, and let me see if I can share it with people. Here we go. Can everybody see this?
Just to explain what the map is. It is a screenshot of a German activist group who's been tracking police reports of alleged rapes in purple and attacks on children in red, supposedly committed by migrants in Germany. And that's over this last year or so.
Okay, but you don't know what data this is based on?
Last year to now.
Because you have, like, an incident on the border between Germany and Poland. That does not make sense at all.
It's just a list of, every time the police record something, then they categorize it. Like the yellow, the blue oblongs, those are swimming pools where people have been molested at, I think. Oh, no, they're roads. But they're the roads numbers. But they have another particular colour, which is blue, looks like a book opening, which has the pools as well. But this is since Merkel asked them all to come over.
Crazy.
But look how many of them there are. That's just one group recording Germany as a rule.
And I was just talking to my brother earlier today, and he's going to vote to remain in the EU. So I was wondering what kind of person would vote to remain in the EU. So I guess it's my brother. I've got no idea why.
This is a picture it's was insane. Taken from AustralianNews.com. So it's not sort of like hasn't been verified.
Well, I'm always a little bit careful with these kind of diagrams, because you don't know what is being classified as what, by whom, and for what reason. That's why a lot of times you have classifications which doesn't make sense. The same thing with rape, for example. When there was this thing about rape in every fifth girl in the university or college in the US is going to get raped. And if you look at this, then it's absolute bullshit. It's not true. It's a lie. It's just that they have classified. If I go to a girl and I say to her, yes, but you're good looking today, boof, it's considered as rape. And then it goes into that statistics. And this is why I'm wondering what it is that is being classified here. Like if you're taking with the swimming pool, if I take a look at a girl and I admire her body, well, then is that being classified? Or is it only when the cops are being called that because some people feel
that... Well, it's cops, isn't it? Because that's what I did say in their blurb. It's reported incidents by the police. Not to, by the police.
Okay.
Yeah, we know there are lots of incidents of theft and rape. I mean, the point is that these migrants are being painted by the left as, oh, they're fleeing from desperate situations. Well, if you were fleeing from a desperate situation, you'd be happy just to have sanctuary. You wouldn't be going around violating the law and giving the finger to the local population. So, I mean, it just blows out of the water, this idea. They're all so innocent and they're all fleeing
Well, I think anybody who's got an ounce of common sense just steps over the political... It's the Syrian refugee message straight away, because the facts are it's two groups are coming over, Syrians and non-Syrians. And the non-Syrians are coming from North Africa, mid-Africa, and all the way over to Afghanistan.
Okay, but why are the Syrians coming all the way through Europe? To Western Europe.
Some of the Syrians coming all the way over is because they've been promised things. They've got relatives here. They've got this, that, and the other. But they are the ones who are supposedly running away to get the benefits which have been promised to them by likes of Merkel. It's the other lot who are apparently doing the damage who are coming from North Africa and Afghanistan and saying they've got a right. They're also running. Do not treat us like animals. And then raping children.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised if some Syrians are doing the damage as well.
Yeah, but it's not. That's the ironic thing. The Syrians, on the whole, are not causing the damage. They really are running away, whilst this other lot are...
How do we know that?
I've been reading the reports, Jeremy.
Well, come on.
The reports I've been finding have said no Syrians have been involved. It's all been people from North Africa as other depraved areas where they practice stupid, barbaric tendencies that these people are doing in our country.
Well, Syria's a bit of a depraved area, isn't it?
Yeah, but I'm not going around saying they're all Syrian refugees.
Yeah, but we've got a girl now who's from Syria.
The majority of Syrian refugees are around the borders of Syria, living in camps. And there's something like 4 or 5 billion of them. They're millions.
Okay, but we've got a new girl from Syria, and she was educated outside, partially in Syria, partially outside. She's got a PhD. I mean, she's fucking brilliant. And she's from Syria. So, you know, you can't generalize this and apply this to everyone.
How do you mean you've got a new girl?
Colleague.
Work colleague.
Yes. Well, I don't work in a brothel, and she's not working as a hooker. So
just reading on Twitter, Hindu activist Raju brutally murdered in Mysore 2 to 3 hours ago. Motive unconfirmed, hashtag atrocities on Hindus.
Oh, goodness. Okay, can we just get back to what I suggested, that we get... I don't know, I still haven't got any kind of, like really bits here. What is it that Islam can be reformed to? Because the argument was that this stupid girl in this iERA chat was saying, well, if I look at the sexualization of people and the gender exploitation of marketing messages and things like that, is that what we are going to be reformed into? And that is stupid. That's like really childish. So, but then what is the alternative? What do I want from Islam, for example? And I want it to be exactly what this Dr. Taj said, And that is a free-for-all, a spiritual guidance thing, and that is it. Take away the politics. End of story. What are other ideas? I still haven't got anything other than say, well, do away with it and get rid of all the violence, get rid of this and get rid of that. Is there anything, any kind of a program? Is Sam Harris and what Majid Nawaz, what Irshad Manji do, what they are doing, is that what it is that we are looking for in Islam?
I think you should historicize it, make it more like about history and so on. And and just become cultural Muslims. But the problem, I don't know, the problem is that if you have a lot of cultural Muslims, after a while you're going to get real Muslims. And if you get real Muslims, you're going to get real jihadists and if you and so on. So I don't know. Oh, you should. I think, but yeah, that's the best option, I think. Historicized version of Islam.
Promote over and over again, God does not exist. This is a fairy story. Father Christmas is just as valid as Allah. And when enough people firmly believe this, it might solve our problems. Not just with Islam, but with all the religions that try to dictate.
No, GP, you can't.
We can.
No, there
we
are.
Can.
Come on.
We can. God does not exist. Where are we lying? We're not.
No,
you're being promoted in schools. We stop it getting tax breaks.
None of that's not the point. The point is
no religion.
If you live in Africa and you look at the way
we do what the Catholic Church does and say, are you an African Muslim? Well, no money for you.
If you live in Africa and you see the way that people live, if you go to the Bushmen, if you go back to
let's go to Africa and see how their lords live. Let's see how their dictator in charge lives, running around in his Rolls Royce with his armored tanks and fly-by jet fighters.
You can't take Mugabe as an example for everything.
I'm taking everything in Africa.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that the people. Yeah, but the people have this demand. There is a demand in Africa, for example, for
snake oil. And you tell them the snake oil doesn't exist, and they won't waste their money paying somebody who represents a snake oil company.
There is a demand in Africans for something spiritual. GP, come on, let me just finish.
They have their own spiritual leaders and myths and legends.
There's a demand for something spiritual. There's a demand for something that will give them some sort of comfort, some sort of support in the so-called afterlife. So there is this pent-in, there is a demand within black Africans. It is part of the culture. That is not something that you can simply do away with by saying, no, there isn't.
Well, I've met an alternative from Africa.
Sorry, you were speaking while I was speaking, so you'll
I've
have to repeat
what you just said. I've met Muslims who are ex-Muslims from Africa, so obviously they don't share the same opinion about
No, it's not about Muslims. GP, it's not about Muslims. There are other things. You can't just go and tell
Christians from Africa as well.
You can't just go and tell all the Muslims in Africa, listen, all that you heard is wrong. Now you need to go towards Christianity and you're not allowed to.
No, I'm not saying go towards Christianity. That God is false.
Boko Haram is not something that comes about that is going to disappear. When you give people power, when you give them the absolute power over life and death, and when you give them, when they take the power that they have now, it is not so easy to get rid of it again. You need to, I mean, look at the continent of Africa. Look how many countries there are. There are 51 countries. How many of these are dysfunctional? 99%. It was always Egypt in the north, South Africa in the south. Now South Africa is going down the drain. Egypt is going down the drain. So how many countries are left?
South Africa is mainly because of colonialism that it's functional.
Yeah, but now it's not working like that anymore. That's why it's going down the drain.
What I was going to say was you were talking about how there's a spiritual need in Africa.
Yes.
That's I think I'd probably agree to some extent. But the trouble with that is a lot of people, probably like me, I honestly do not know what the word spiritual even means. And when someone says I have a need for spiritual nourishment, that's like, I'd take the Christopher Hitchens line, that's white noise to me. I honestly have no idea what spiritual nourishment is. But they apparently do. A bunch of people apparently do have this notion of what spiritual is. It's something that I completely lack.
Superman.
Actually, look, Superman. No, if you talk about spirituality, I think the word spirituality is kind of... I don't like that word. But I don't like the word psychology either, because it's like, it is as if a soul existed. I don't believe in the soul. But, I mean, I think, like, Sam Harris has written this book, like, Spirituality Without Religion. And I think it is possible to have a kind of spirituality, or whatever you call it,
without... But what's the definition of that? I literally don't know what that means.
No, I don't know exactly either. But, like, Spinoza, for example.
It's the belief in something supernatural, which is not necessarily bound to the laws that we have in naturalism.
No, but that's not what Sam Harris believes in.
Spirituality was shown to be the absence of brain functions when you pray.
I don't know. I think they
They wired people up to MRIs.
Okay, so if you take a scientist that look at
it... Their brain stopped working in certain key areas, and that gave them an artificial bliss. So when people get spiritual, they're basically shutting down their brains and releasing chemicals that make them feel better.
Yeah, but I think we have orgasms for that, so this is...
Yes, orgasm is probably another nice word for it.
But then there are people who would say they're being spiritual and they're not feeling blissful. They're just sort of being really pious and they're chanting or whatever. They're not necessarily feeling blissful when they're being spiritual.
It's like Buddhists. I mean, what do they do? Normally, what they go is they meditate. And this is something that gives you this spiritual feeling, this high when you are just inside of yourself. You're not thinking, doing, or doing anything for a purpose. When you are just thinking about a topic, when you are meditating over something with some music and blah, blah, blah. And a lot of people need that. A lot of people want that. And I'm like Jeremy. I don't really understand this. I don't know what the spiritual actually is. I just take it to mean that it's supernatural and that it is something that you say, okay, I'm not requiring this to be demonstrable. I'm not requiring this to be detectable. This is just something that is something to do with my brain and that is something about my thoughts, and my thoughts are dissected from my physical brain. And that is basically it. That is what I understand what spirituality is. That then you go and you manifest that in some form. Some people take it as Superman, some people take it as a god. Same thing. Or Santa Claus, same thing. I mean, I'd love for Superman to exist or something like that. Brilliant, but it doesn't. So I don't need this. I don't need a god in my life. But a lot of these people need some sort of supernatural being in their life. So how do you cater for that?
I think you have to make a difference between needing a god and... I mean, as I said, I don't like the word spirituality, but let's say that you have a kind of scientist that looks at an image taken by the Hubble telescope, and you have a feeling of awe of the greatness of the cosmos.
There you go.
Can't you call that a kind of spirituality?
Yes, absolutely.
But isn't that
What about paedophiles? They feel a need to have sex with children, but we don't say, well, we've got to allow them somehow to express that need. We say, no, your brain is malfunctioning and we don't think you should do it.
Yeah, but it needs to be within the constraints of society.
Yeah, I don't really see why we should take any different attitude to spirituality. No, the consequences aren't necessarily as bad as paedophilia, but it's the same principle of there's something, your brain is just malfunctioning. There's no reason you should feel that need.
Yeah, but hang on. If you want to rape little girls, but you never do it, is that a crime?
No, but your brain is malfunctioning, and there's no reason. It would be better if your brain were not feeling that need.
Okay.
Why are you trying to defend religion?
Who?
You are.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
You want to keep religion. No,
then they have a need, and therefore you must pander to it. even if that need is a fake need, even if that need is an abusive need.
No, no, no. Then I'm coming across completely wrong. I'm not defending religion at all.
Religion. No. Not ban it, but just simply say it's wrong, it's false, it's fake, it doesn't exist, your God isn't real, you can't enforce your laws on me. Nah.
Okay. What I'm saying is people who want to think, who want to believe something should be allowed to. I cannot prohibit people from thinking something. If somebody needs an artificial crutch, then they should have that. So that does not mean that I am now defending religion. It means that I am trying to find an alternative for those people who need this, who have had a religion, who have had a God, and now suddenly they're being told, no, there is no such thing. What is a viable alternative for that?
They don't need their money. They don't need their tax cuts. They don't need their special privileges. Just because their God says they can throw people off buildings because they're homosexuals doesn't mean you should cater for it.
Exactly. So this is exactly what I'm saying. If
your God does not exist, it is false. Your Bible is made up of false claims that never happened. You are not going to change the history books in America to say things like Moses was the founding father of American constitutional issues.
Okay. So what do you do? Now you've told everybody what not to do, but so what do you do?
Well, that's
you
what
you just
doing,
tell people, well, tough luck, fuck you, there's no God, yes. Just live with it.
Yes, just live with it.
I actually don't agree. I think most of both, like Dawkins and Sam Harris and all of these guys are talking about this, that you can have a kind of, actually, I don't like the word spirituality, but in lack of better words, you can have something that is even better than that, like having an awe of the universe, like realizing how immense the universe is and how weird our situation is and all that. I mean, and thinking about like how old the earth is and all that kind of stuff, like nature and things like that. I mean, you can have that instead. You see what I'm saying? And music, yeah, and art and things like that.
Those things are real. Art is real. It's a manifestation of what the mind thinks and puts onto pen and paper.
Yeah. So, but I mean, if you want to have like, of course, if you want to have, if you need a kind of daddy in the sky that takes care of you, of course, you're not going to have that.
Well, we give them Donald Trump. He's
Well,
his daddy and his mind.
That doesn't work for me, I'm sorry. But, but like, you have to become God yourself. You have to look at... do you know the physicist Max Tegmark? He's Scandinavian, by the way. Anyway, he have this because of science, we have realized that we are completely insignificant. We are not the center of the universe. We are nothing. There's TJ, maybe know this. Have you heard this? It's the beginning of a book written by Nietzsche quite early in his life. I memorized it. It goes like this. Once upon a time, in some out-of-the-way corner of that universe, there was a star upon which clever beasts invented knowing. That was the most arrogant and mendacious minute of world history, but nevertheless, it was only a minute. After nature had drawn a few breaths, the star cooled and congealed, and the clever beasts had to die. One might invent such a fable, but yet he still would not have adequately illustrated how miserable, how shadowy, how aimless and arbitrary the human intellect looks within nature. There were eternities during which it did not exist, and when it's all over with the human intellect, nothing will have happened. Anyway, so that kind of illustrates how insignificant we are. But what Max Tegmark says is that in one way we are very significant, because if we are the only creatures in the whole universe that have subjective experience and can experience the universe, in a way we are the ones that makes that. I mean, without us there would be no one to experience it. So yes, experiencing the universe is quite meaningful, I think. So you can find a kind of, I don't know, I think that's better than believing in a God that doesn't exist.
So is that an alternative to Allah?
Yeah, that makes us very significant. And you should take that responsibility, and I really have to experience the universe, because without us, the whole universe would be completely meaningless.
Okay, so if I go now to, I don't know, to the Sutu, and I go to the mountains there, and I tell the people, listen, guys, do away with your gods, do away with your spirits, do away with your ancestors. So I'm sorry, they don't exist. Look at the universe. What are they going to tell me? What happens if I... Well, no, let's go to Muslims. Let's go to Nigeria. Let's go to the north of Nigeria, or go to Gambia or whatever, and tell them, listen, guys, you just called your country the Islamic Republic. But now there is no such thing as Islam. There is no God. What are they going to do?
Well, that's the problem. I mean, I think Ernest Becker, you know him?
No.
No, well, anyway. He was talking about, like, some tribe somewhere when they met, like, Westerners for the first time. And they realized that, like, their worldview wasn't true. And, like, the what they thought was the meaning of life wasn't, like a part of the structure of the universe, whatever you should call it. So they pretty much laid down and died because the meaning of their life had disappeared. So it's a serious problem. I mean, people need...
But if that happened with Islam, that would be quite a simple solution to the problem, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, you are wicked.
That.
But you said, what are they going to do? Well, what are they going to do that's going to be a problem for us? Is this the better question?
No, I have more compassion than that. I mean, if I destroy an entire worldview, if I destroy a whole, like, the entire concept of a god, shouldn't I also say, well, hang on, there is something that you can still hang on to. Give me your crutches, I'll give you a wheelchair. Or give me your wheelchair, I'll give you some crutches. So if
why don't you just heal them? Why don't you heal their broken bones and get them off religion?
I don't think that's possible. I think it takes more time. I think it will take several generations before gods are gone out of our brain.
Yeah, but you're not going to do it by placating religion and trying to find some way to keep it going.
Well, if I go and reform Islam, and I say, all right, let's do away with all this violence. Let's do away with misogynism. Let's do away with everything that is negative about Islam. Isn't that a step in the right direction?
Do away with everything that's negative about Islam. So do away with Islam.
Well, not going so far, because I think you can't take away cars. I mean, you can't say, okay, cars are bad for the environment, so let's go and just abolish all cars.
Yeah, but cars. What's the cars analogy about?
They could and they would. The only thing that stops them is the car lobbies.
No, I'm talking about people. You were talking about cars. Do away with them.
You were talking about cars. And cars
aren't incompatible with a liberal democracy, are they?
Cars could be got rid of tomorrow if all the governments in the world decided no more cars, we're all going electric. But the car lobby groups would protest like mad and buy as many politicians as they can. And it's the same thing with the religions. If you try to ban a religion, most religious groups will try and lobby and protest and try and buy off as many politicians as they can.
Right. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to make it a viable solution by getting people to accept it.
Then you have to start right at the beginning and say right at the early age of every child that's born, there is no God. He doesn't exist.
Exactly. Well, you can't ban religion, but you can make sure children have a reasonable secular upbringing, or you can certainly in countries that aren't Muslim majority countries, I think you can do that. And the trouble is people these days are trying to placate religion. They're trying to say things like, parents have the right to raise their children the way they want. Well, they don't, because we don't let them beat their children, for example. So why do we let them brainwash them into religion?
Okay, so have faith at least we agree on that one, because this is exactly my point. You need to phase it out. And that is what I'm trying to say now, that we need to do away with the gods, we need to do away with the negativity, so we need to phase this out. And we can't go about it by just saying, look, there's no gods, deal with it. I think it needs to be a little bit of a gentler approach towards the people who have been brainwashed and indoctrinated since childhood with this god belief.
But you have to make some very radical and positive steps to prevent the God Squad from being on top. For example,
exactly.
You have to say things like, there shall be no blasphemy laws.
Okay, exactly. And this is now where I was hoping that we could go, where people make constructive, this is the constructive criticism process, where you go and you say, okay, this is the situation, this is what is pernicious about the situation, and now let's go and take a look what it is that we can do to soften it, and then what we can do is...
You were given the answer to this by me right at the very start, at 6:20 p.m., when I told you that they just need to enforce secular laws. They can believe whatever they like, but if they break a law, they go to jail. Yours, Jimmy.
If you don't think you can just tell people to stop being religious, if you don't think that's viable, why do you think it's viable to sort of say, well, stop abiding by some of your religious laws? You know, why is some of it viable?
Because it's a phased-in, multi-step process.
But isn't religion basically an all or nothing? I mean, don't you have to accept all of it or accept that the whole thing is nonsense?
No, that's exactly what I'm saying. That the idea of a god you do away with, and then you maintain this what you call the cultural aspect. So you have cultural Jews who still go about some things which they consider to be normal, the same way as a cultural Muslim will still not eat pork, for example. So these are the things that don't have a victim, and I think there's nothing wrong with them.
I'd say once you've got to the point of cultural Islam, you've done away with religion entirely. That's not religion anymore. So you're basically, if you're arguing to go from Islam to cultural Islam, you're basically arguing to just do away with religion immediately.
Yes. Okay, but
that's not viable.
Okay. Yeah, no, but hang on. What is it? What do we need to do to get there? Because that, for me, is the third step. That is already a result. That would be the formulation of a result where we say, okay, what is it that we want to reform Islam to? We want to reform it so that people become cultural Muslims. What is necessary to put them in that direction? What is the process map going to look like to achieve that result, that goal?
You'd have to be tribal. You'd have to stop migration. You couldn't have people who didn't have the same beliefs as you have coming into your country to have what you're after.
Look what happened to Western Christianity. We didn't did we say okay, we need to reform Christianity and things like that? No, it was more like a conflict between Darwin and Christians.
Well, it started off with the Protestants and the Catholics, didn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
The Year War and
the Protestants and the Catholics didn't sort of go to the, the Protestants and the other Reform Christianities didn't go to the Catholic Church and try and bargain with them and persuade them to reform. They just rejected Catholicism.
Yes.
So they yeah.
I think Martin Luther actually tried to influence the Pope.
Yeah. Well, Tom Holland made a very good point here, because he said what enabled Martin Luther was the printing press. So the Reformation of Christianity, the enabler, was the printing press, because suddenly the people were able to read the Bible, which before was only for the clergy because it was in Latin. And now all of a sudden the people were able to read what it actually said in there. And the same thing we have today in Islam, which is the internet, because now all of a sudden every Muslim can realize what it is his texts say, what they are based on, what the Hadith say, what that is based on, and they can go and dissect all the different components of Sharia. So this is the same thing that enables the Reformation of Islam today.
Well, I'm going to get a bit confused, because Muslims I found will quote various different Qurans which have completely different verses. What I mean is the one about smiting people's heads off if they change their faith. I've read the Ahmadiyyan, sorry, not the Ahmadiyya.
Ahmadiyya
quote, and it's changed from kill to should. They should die, not okay. They will die.
Yeah, but you see, this is the whole point. Is it worth rewriting the Quran?
No.
Don't get an interpretation. Okay, what I always say, Muslims need to take ownership of their ideology so that we don't have exactly this situation, so that Muslims can tell us once and for all what it says in the Quran. Does 434 mean hit the women, or does it mean split with them? This is the point that I need to clarify with all Muslims, and Muslims need to have one version of this so that it is...
Well, why go that far? They've lost the argument. They can't prove God exists, therefore he doesn't. Why go on about a book on the verse? It is the point.
No, you are going one step too far for me.
I'm going right to the basics.
No, you're going digital.
Why fiddle about with one verse when they've got thousands of verses they can argue with? They can quote a million verses, and you have to try and knock down every single one, or else you could just turn around and say, your God doesn't exist. Therefore, all your arguments are pointless.
Okay, GP, let me ask you something. If you go tomorrow, you go to all Muslims and you tell them there is no God, deal with it. What is the reaction that you're going to get?
I get blocked on Twitter.
Okay, so have you helped anybody in any way?
Possibly. I don't know who's been reading in the background. I actually got a like today from somebody who blocked me.
What if you're in government and you make sure children get secular educations? You might not change this generation, but you can change the next generation and the generation after that.
Yeah, but we need to have viable goals. We need to have exactly what you are doing now, saying what is possible. And this is something that is possible. What we need to do is tell the government, listen, guys, go and impose secular values. Don't go and allow faith schools. That is the first step. Go and look at what Islam actually says. Go and modify this. And this is the way we do it. But we need to have points. We can't just do what GP says and says, listen, fuck this. We just go, no God, fuck you, and now shut up. That doesn't work. This is not a viable...
Why not? Path. It has worked in the past.
No, it hasn't.
Why do you think there are no Vikings running around lobbing people's heads off? Because they were told their gods don't exist.
It took hundreds of years before people realized this.
No, it took one person turning around to say, your God does not exist, mine does, so fuck off.
Wasn't it more to do with the forceful conversion to Christianity of Scandinavia?
No.
Okay, but what is that? That's exactly my point. You're giving them an alternative. We are not. We are saying there is no God. Live with it. There's no alternative.
There is no God.
Exactly. And I think that is too brutal. That is not
it's going to be accepted by people. It's sane, and it doesn't matter if they accept it or not. It's still a truth.
That's not going to help anybody. It's not going to help constructive.
They can fly if they jump out of an aeroplane. It's far better to turn around and say it's very brutally, if you jump out of a plane without a parachute, you're going to die.
Okay, but if you're trying to be realistic and you're trying to bring something to the table,
realistic.
You can't tell me that I am defending religion if I'm trying to be realistic. It's not realistic to go on Twitter today and say there's no God.
You've got a child who's having a tantrum because he wants to have something which he can't have, and you're saying, well, if you can't give him that, I'll give him something else, which is just the same. Instead of buying him a teddy bear that's 6 foot tall, I'll give him a 4 foot teddy bear.
Okay, I give up.
It should do.
GPZ, I have a question, GPZ. Don't you think somebody already tried this to say to the people, there is no God?
Know. Apart from Hitchens.
I think it is tried in the past. And those people who say in countries with majorities of Muslims and the laws are towards Sharia, they get killed. they just get killed. And end of story.
Looking at Western societies, though, that actually hasn't been tried very much in Western societies, because we have faith in the UK. We have faith schools. We have a government that panders far too much to religion. We have a national broadcaster that feels it has to kowtow to religion all the time. So it seems to me it hasn't been tried by the establishment to just deny religion and to stop pandering to it.
If you've got places like Russia,
in the UK, in the whole world, it has been tried in the past. It's not some action that is made, and the next day everybody says, well, that's good, never told us anybody about this, so let's do it.
You had one person in the West, if you can call it the West, Stalin, who tried to shut up the Catholic Church or the Russian Orthodox Church in Russia, but he didn't really try to get rid of it, because he was using the very methodology of the Church in his country to control it. That's why now the biggest proponents for bringing back communism happen to be the Christians. So it hasn't been tried. People have tried to reinvent religions, like in North Korea, where now the God is the political leader, but nobody's actually turned around and tried to say there is no God.
What did Hitchin say? Did he say there is a God?
Hitchin has said there is no God.
Okay, what impact did that have?
It probably made a few people turn to atheism.
Do you still have Christians in the US?
You got less.
Yes, maybe 15 or 20
now.
But you've still got 2 billion of them where it didn't work. So if you have 20 where it worked and 2 billion where it didn't work, I would say that successful.
I think 50% of them was left, according to the statistics. If you look at what it was before Hitchens and Dawkins started prophetizing there was no God, something like I said, 80% of Americans were Christians, and something like 40% of them believed that Noah's Ark was real. But now you've got something like 40% are saying they're Christians, and only 40% of those people believe the same stories of Genesis.
Okay,
and it's had a dramatic effect, and it's snowballing. If you look at the way that YouTube and Twitter and all the sort of like social media has reacted, you can't go through any of these sites without stumbling across atheists.
So how many years has that taken?
God, it's within my lifetime, isn't it?
Yeah, okay, but you still have Christians.
20 years, 30 years.
But you still have Christians. It hasn't worked. You still get them.
Do you want to do the Muslim thing and just chop off their heads?
No. But what I'm saying is simply declaring there is no God
It's working.
Okay.
It takes time, but you'd want to have things solved in an instant.
Okay, go out now, write a Twitter message, there's no God. And then let's check tomorrow if Islam is still there.
You're ludicrous. I tell you what I can do this year. I can vote to leave Europe, and that'll make a dramatic change.
To Islam?
Yeah, stop Muslims coming over from the Middle East and via Germany.
Oh, there were no Muslims coming over when there was no EU?
There's going to be a hell of a lot more when they get their German passports.
That assumes that the post-Brexit government is going to implement proper border control, which hopefully they would.
Hopefully they will, yeah. There's things we can do, and there's things we are doing. And I think you're living in cuckoo land.
Okay. All right. So have we found any pathway in the way of reformation for Islam?
If you want it done overnight, then the only way to do it, I suppose, would have to be via conquest.
I did not say overnight, no.
Yes, you did.
I did not. You said
to me, you write on Twitter, God does not exist, let's see how many Muslims there'll be on the internet tomorrow. As if you want to happen overnight, a complete change in people believing in God.
But that was your suggestion.
No, my suggestion is just to say there is no God. Therefore, no special privileges. And that means the whole gamut. No special privileges, no tax evasion, no political influences. Just because you say God says, means absolutely nothing to me. Okay, have your arguments, by all means, but let your arguments win by their merit, not because God says.
Yeah, but we know that that doesn't work.
What do you mean it doesn't work? There's a whole country called the United States of America that works on that principle, separation of church and state. I'm supposed to, anyway.
Technically, that's not the same thing as saying God doesn't exist. It's saying don't allow religion to have privilege when it comes to government decisions.
Exactly. But it's just the only way you can deal with it without basically executing people who are stubborn and don't want to change. I mean, that's how they used to deal with it in the old days. If you were a Catholic and you lived in a Protestant neighbourhood, they'd just kill you. But now there's a bit of tolerance going on, saying you can have your religious beliefs as long as it doesn't break the laws of the land.
Yeah, what if it does break the laws of the land? That's the trouble.
When it does break the laws of the land, then you go through the judicial system and get put in prison when caught.
And what if it doesn't?
Then they haven't caught.
Okay, but should you punish somebody for having a religious belief without damaging anybody else?
It depends on the religious belief, isn't it?
If they're bringing their kids up with that belief, they're damaging their kids. I would posit. They're damaging their kids' ability to think critically.
Yes, if their religious belief says they can't take their children to doctors, they must pray for them instead. Then that's
well, it's not just that. It's believing, it's raising them to think that evolution is untrue and that you have to kill apostates and you have to be a Muslim, and it's definitely true that the Islamic faith is correct. All of this assuredness about everything, which is completely unjustified, is stultifying their thinking.
God does not exist, therefore you should not go around teaching children that God exists, because you're spreading a lie, which could cause them harm when they get older.
So you are saying, GP, that we should not reform Islam, we should just abandon it immediately, and that's it.
Yeah. It's the only way in the end that's going to deal with the whole question of gods and deities and things that are telling everybody else what to do.
Okay, Jeremy, what is your solution?
My solution? Is he asking me?
Yeah, correct.
I basically agree with GPZ. I think we should reject Islam. The reform route is being attempted by the likes of Majid Nawaz and Ayn Hirsi Ali, so they are trying that route. They're trying to go around finding reformers, but I don't know. It seems bizarre to me that you would take something that you acknowledge is basically man-made and completely incorrect and say, well, let's try and partially water it down, rather than just going straight to the truth, where you've recognised that it's man-made. Why would you sort of half believe in a god when you realise it's been man-made?
Because I don't see that this is a viable, workable solution that will have any impact, because it will not work at the end of the day if you simply tell people. I mean, it's like a smoker. I mean, you're addicted to smoking. And then you tell people, well, it's bad for your lungs. Does it mean people are going to stop smoking? No, it doesn't. So you need to go with the flow. And then now, over the last 100 years, we have reduced smoking. There are still smokers, but it's maybe 50% of what it used to be in the past. So it's a matter of phasing it out through argumentation, through rational reasoning, through all the arguments. And I think the same way what we should do with Islam. You can't from one day to the next take a crack addict and say, there's no more crack for you, go and deal with it, and if you want to kill yourself, well, go ahead, fuck you.
In the case of smoking, the smokers are acknowledging that it's bad for their health, but they're just addicted and it's difficult for them to give it up. But in the case of religion, they're not even acknowledging that the religion is incorrect. The second you get them to acknowledge that the religion is incorrect, it's very hard for me to put myself in their shoes, but every fibre of my being believes that God actually exists, it's an all or nothing proposition for me. The second I'm convinced that it's man-made, I'm not going to believe in 50% of it. I'm not going to think, well, some of it, God's sort of true. It's kind of like virginity. You're either definitely a virgin or not. You're either definitely, you believe that God exists, or if it's man-made, then why would you water down your beliefs instead of just abandoning them? It doesn't make sense to me to water them down.
Well, the other approach is to say, well, maybe there is a God, but this God does not command you to go and kill people and not to demand that somebody be a virgin on the wedding night and things like that, to do away with all that bullshit.
So changing the nature of the God.
Correct.
Which is okay until you look at the core text of Islam and realize that that they don't support reform in that way, really. In fact, they preemptively warn against the peacemakers and the reformers, and then they basically lump them in with the infidels in chapter 2.
Yeah, but that's different. That is adding gods. This is a different approach. What we're trying to do is change the nature of this God into a benign God. But that's not the point.
Exactly,
the point was just to find reformation, to find whether this is a path that is going to promise any kind of, I don't know, betterment or any kind of improvement or any kind of a viable approach to life that people can accept and walk through. This was just an attempt to see what is it that people make of this, what people ask, and what people think about this.
Do you acknowledge that the Quran itself preemptively warns against reformers and explicitly says that they're not proper Muslims?
It's the concept of bid'ah, and the concept of bid'ah is adding gods and adding things which are not constructive towards Islam, which are in any way endangering the concept of tawhid, this oneness of one God. So if that is being challenged, then there's an allergy towards that. That is correct. That's what it warns against. It doesn't say that you should not interpret this. It doesn't say this is what God wants, so you need to understand it. That's exactly what it says. Now, the thing is that if you say Jesus is like Adam made from dust, does that mean both?
Hang on a minute. I'm talking about like 2:11. 2:11 is what you're talking about, is it?
What is 2:11?
When asked to desist from spreading corruption in the land, they say, why, we are reformers or peacemakers. Yet surely they're mischiefmongers, even though they don't know it.
When asked to desist from spreading corruption, we are reformers. Yeah, okay. And the reform, that is exactly it. The reform, now you need to interpret this. What is a reformer? Reforming in what way?
Well, presumably taking a plausible or any... taking part of the Quran where any plausible interpretation means violence against a certain group of people. So chapter 9, it's either violence against polytheists or pagans. It's certainly violence against someone. And saying, no, the Quran doesn't preach violence against anyone. That I would call a reform.
Okay,
because you're definitely trying to change the only plausible interpretation of what the Quran is saying.
Correct. That is what you call reform. And this is what Dr. Taj says, a restoration, going back to... Because what you started the sentence off with was presumably, and this is exactly the wrong word, because we can't presume that.
So what was presumably?
That's what you started saying. You said presumably that's what it means with the reformers.
I think, look, Staff, I kind of agree with Jeremy. If you read the Quran and so on, it's extremely hard to... You really have to bend over backwards if you want to, like, reform it in the way...
No, that's why I say you need to rewrite it. This is the question. Do you rewrite the Quran entirely, or do you take passages out and make them 100% clear? Do not hit the women, but split with them. Boom. It does not say hit anymore. Change the word to split with them so that it
becomes... Seriously, do you think it's more realistic to change the Quran now than to just get rid of Islam? I think it's harder to change...
This is what the Quran is saying about you. There are some who, though they say we believe in God on the last day, in reality they don't believe. They try to deceive God and those who believe, yet deceive none but themselves, although they don't know it. Sick of their hearts, and God adds to their malady. For them is a suffering because they lie. When asked to desist from spreading corruption, they say, we're only reformers. Surely they're mischief mongers, even though they don't know it. When asked to believe as others do, they say, should we believe like fools? And yet they are the fools, even though they don't know it, and so on. The Quran preemptively talks about reformers, and it says, you know, tell them to sod off. They're not real Muslims. They are mischief makers, they're evil, they're fools, God hates them. How can you possibly reform a text that preemptively condemns anyone who's going to try and do this?
Okay. So we need to phase out Islam completely.
I mean, it's just a question of whether reform is more likely in that context where it's preemptively rejected you as an evil person, or rejection is more likely to succeed.
Well, the only way you could reform it the way Spam wants to reform it is to dig up the original and oldest versions of the Quran and say anything that followed this particular version was added to or changed from the original. If there are more verses, than this one, then obviously those verses are fake and they were never there.
Yeah, but also to change the wording so that you do not need to interpret it.
You don't have to really change the wording because the original script has multiple meanings. You just have to use the words which mean what you think it should mean.
Okay, but you have to be one of the reformers then.
No, what I'm saying is the original Quran was written in a way which is open not to interpretation but to the way you've been taught it's been saying. It's a prompt. For instance, you were taught a poem and you learnt the poem and you read the Quran and you try and say the poem, you might get to a particular word, but the letters on the page only hint at the word you've remembered. It doesn't tell you what the word is. It could mean donkey, it could mean horse, it could mean cow, but because you've been taught it means cow, you say cow. So when you use the original Qurans, the oldest Qurans, you have that particular type of Arabic where you can replace sometimes the word to mean what you think is most favourable.
Does that apply to this part of chapter 2 in the original
Arabic? Yes, probably, because the originally there were 7 Qurans written in 7 different Arabic tribal dialects, which had different interpretations. That was the original one. Then they got up to the third caliph. He destroyed and burnt all of those and just had his versions. But when you got to the caliphs of the Ottoman Empire, there was currently 14 different verses or versions of particular verses, and they whittled it down to 1 out of 14. So yes, if you can see the way it's diverted, the different accents and the different tribal inflections, there's probably a great deal of scope there.
And what are your chances of persuading the average Muslim of that?
Well,
them to reject the religion altogether. I mean, I'd say the chances are about similar, really.
I'd say it's a lot better percentage-wise to say this is the original Quran and we translated it and we can prove it's the oldest Quran ever. And they'll probably believe that because they know in their Islamic history that the Quran has gone through different stages of rewritten, republished.
Do they, though? Because most Muslims think it was the perfect word of God that never changed.
Oh, yes, they most definitely do. You can talk to any of them. They'll refer back to Uthman and Abu Bakr.
Well, earlier we were talking about this, and we came to the conclusion that the best bet is actually using history. Because if you use history, you can show that the way that it has been implemented, the way that it has been designed, is not the way that it is being seen today. You can show very easily that there is a dissonance between the way that it was designed and the way that it was implemented and show, no, that is wrong. So you have to go and abandon the idea that it is of divine origins.
Under no circumstances can you use history. Because if you use history, you have got ISIS.
I'm talking about history, not fairy tales.
Muhammad was a brutal, narcissistic, psychopathic.
There is no evidence historically that he existed. I'm talking about history, not fairy tales.
You're looking at a history with Arabs conquering nearly...
That is not historical.
...half of the known world. It is
historical. That is not historical.
It conquered half the known world. How can you say that is not historical?
What date are you talking about?
Oh... going up to about 100 years after his death.
That's not historical.
I'm a... What the? Are you on drugs? Seriously,
no.
Are you talking... Are you on drugs? Are you telling me things that happened in history are not historical?
What is historical is whatever started with the Umayyads. And that's 100 years after Muhammad. I mean, Muhammad was born like 570, and we're talking 660 when the Umayyads came in, and this is when we start looking at history.
You mean that's when we start having a historical being relatively sure about what actually happened?
Correct.
But we've got a pretty reasonable, pretty shrewd idea of what they were up to before then, haven't we? I mean, they weren't exactly peaceful.
No, there's nothing.
So they could have been peaceful, completely peaceful.
We don't know. There's nothing we don't know
killing,
about it.
Not killing a bunch of Jews on the Arabian Peninsula or anything like that.
Correct.
Well, I
think you're incorrect, Spam. I'm pretty sure there is evidence from the Christian community, the Byzantians, who referred to this prophet that was going around killing people.
No.
And converting. Yes.
No.
Yes.
Well, then show me.
I probably will have to sometime later in the week.
You have all you have is things like the Jacobi doctrine, which is like years after Muhammad allegedly died, and they don't talk about Muhammad, the prophet of Allah, but they talk about the false prophet sitting on a chariot.
You've got the that Christian bishop from
Eusebius. Okay, he doesn't mention Muhammad either.
No, there's one that does, and he quotes the Qur'an.
Okay, if you have something new there that contradicts my research, cool, bring it. Nobody has found anything in that direction yet. If you're the first one, brilliant!
I'm not the first one. I had it pointed out to me by somebody who studies Islam, and he was using it as a defense on something much on the same lines as you, but he was a bishop of somewhere.
Yeah, I know.
And again, if it's ahistorical to go before the Umayyads, are you saying that the chapter 9 of the Quran is sort of ahistorical? Because that's pretty, you can't really interpret that as anything other than kill a certain bunch of non-Muslim religious people.
No, it's not a certain, it's just kill non-believers.
Well, there are parts of it where you can either interpret it as pagans or polytheists.
There you go. This is interpretation.
But the point is, whatever it is, it's not peaceful. It's definitely killing some non-Muslims.
Yes.
So are you saying that's ahistorical, that we can't be sure that that's true Islam, that that's what the original Muslims
No. What I'm saying is we have to look at it in a historical context. So what
historically, the original Muslims believed in killing some kind of non-Muslims based on chapter 9.
The way that the Quran was written is sometime out of the, 7th, 8th century, where the people needed killers. They wanted warriors. They wanted soldiers. They did not want womenizers and drunks in the army. So what they said is, you go and you give me your life now, you give me your ability to fight for me and for my God and for your God, and then your God will reward you for this once you are dead. But now, here in this life, you go and you fight for me. That is what the Quran is telling people.
So it's not peaceful.
It's definitely not peaceful. The intention is not peaceful. The intention is to control people.
I'm not sure what your point is about the fact that the idea that we don't really know what the early Muslims were doing.
Well, this is not the whole point. You go and look at your history, and you find out what it is when Islam actually came about, and you look at the circumstances under which Islam was born, and then you compare this to the text, and you will see that there's a dissonance, because you will see that Mecca did not exist in the way that it is being propagated in the Hadith. You will see that the Sirah is fabricated, because Mecca did not exist at all the way that it is described. So now we have a problem. We have a discrepancy. How do you now consolidate the discrepancy that you find with the text and historicity?
So just to clarify, are you saying your position is that it could be that Islam was initiated as initiated as a religion of peace, and then but only after Muhammad died was it taken over by nefarious forces?
I'm saying it did not exist before the, let's say, before beginning of 8th century.
Islam didn't exist.
Correct.
What was the Prophet Muhammad preaching?
He didn't exist.
Didn't exist.
He didn't exist. Muhammad is like Moses and Jesus, somebody who was taken as a symbol, as a character in a book, who was told, do as the book commands to show that a human is capable of doing that. Because we want a rigorous routine. We need rituals to keep people focused on this. We are not allowing the people to think. We are not allowing the people to wander off and go take the hormones for a walk. They are supposed to be fighting. This is how the whole thing was. I don't know, this was the conception of Islam. Because in those days, Muawiyah started it. He saw how useful a religion can be. And then Abd al-Malik is the one who then used it, who said, okay, let's have the Quran. And then later on, he substantiated that with the Hadith with Muhammad, because he realized he needed a human being to show to people, yes, you as a human being are capable of doing it like that. This is why he sent Muhammad up onto the heavens on his burak, to show that it is actually a mercy that they only have to pray 5 times a day and not 50 times a day. But they get the rewards for it. This is why you have the rewards and the point system, so that anything that you do is being accepted by God. And if a dog or a woman who's menstruating is walking in front of you, it is not accepted, so you're not awarded the points that you need to get into paradise. So the whole thing is the carrot and the whip, where you've shown the carrot, go and fight for me, and then later you will get in paradise, you will get a mansion and the virgins.
So do you think Jesus existed?
No, of course not.
Okay, and do you think Muhammad didn't exist, or it's just possible that he didn't exist?
No, let's be very clear. There probably was a guy who was a charismatic general or warlord or leader, military leader of some sort, and he was then taken and given the attribute of Muhammad, the messenger of this God, to make him special, the same way as Jesus was given the God package. I mean, Apollonius had the same thing as Jesus. So it was just the God package at the time, that you were born into something special, out of something special, by a so-called God, that you could walk on water, you could heal people. This is the standard God package that they had in those days. And Jesus was given the God package to make him special. That's it. So the same thing. They probably took some preacher, charismatic preacher, who wandered around Galilee, and they said, okay, here we take Jesus or Isa or Joshua or whatever, and we give him something special. He's now a god. He was born by a virgin and blah, 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 like all the other gods at the time. And that's it. He was just constructed to be the figurehead of a particular symbolic movement.
So it sounds to me like we're talking about trying to sell to Muslims the idea that Muhammad wasn't divine, he was just some guy that was risen to a state of legend.
Exactly.
Right.
And they're gonna buy that, are they?
Oh, they are. Well, they did. This is what they're buying.
Muhammad, no, I mean, they're going to buy the idea that he's not divine.
Yeah, but he was not born by a god or by a virgin or anything like that. He was a standard bloke who happened to be sitting in a cave, and he, because he was such a brilliant human being, was selected by a god 50,000 light years away to be the representative on Earth, the messenger for this god on Earth, on this planet.
Yeah, but you're saying that's obviously false, and that was just invented later on.
It's a fabrication, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, I'm saying, are Muslims going to accept that? Ever? I mean, if you've been indoctrinated into Islam, one of the most core beliefs that you've got is that Muhammad existed and he was divine and he was God's chosen one.
Okay, but we're talking about Reformation. We're talking about questioning God himself or itself or herself or whatever.
It's like questioning Jesus Christ for a Christian.
Okay, well, that's reality. I mean,
a Christian isn't going to reject Jesus.
give it, people believe it anyway, even though it's reality. So you have, people have selective reality. They know that Jesus did not exist the way that it's being shown in the Gospels. They're just trying to make do with what they have, and they say, well, we believe the Gospels more than we believe reality. Now, Muslims do the same thing.
Right, can I just blow... stop swearing out of the water.
Sure, go
ahead. I refer to you to Wikipedia, where I've actually discovered
Wikipedia's going to blow me out of the water.
I found the name of the person I couldn't remember. His name was John of Damascus, but I found an even earlier source. Let me just read this now.
Who is this?
The earliest documented Christian knowledge of Muhammad stems from the Byzantium sources, written shortly after Muhammad's death in 632.
What is the name of this?
Is this early enough for you? 632?
What is the name of
this? Let me read the book now.
No, can you please give me
the name? In the Doctrina Jacobi Nupra Baptism. Okay.
What is the first thing that I told you what is a false fabrication?
I am telling you,
I told
written
you.
Here because I am fed up with you dominating the conversation.
DP, not I told you in the beginning that the first falsified thing is the Jacobi doctrine. I told you that.
Yes, I'm reading the paragraph. I haven't even got to John of Damascus.
Why can't you...
Right, so you say... You don't want to believe in it. The doctrina is false, okay? Well, what about...
Show me where... No, hang on, read it.
John of Damascus?
Okay, read the Jacobi doctrine. Show me where it mentions Muhammad.
676.
Okay, show me where the doctrina Jacobi mentions Muhammad.
Well, I wasn't using him as a... That was the earliest reference I found, but that wasn't the one wasn't the one I was talking about originally.
What?
The one I was talking about originally was called John of Damascus.
And that reference is what?
His reference you'll find in the Catholic
what does he talk archives. About?
He talks about the...
The contract the of the Jews... He talks about the contracts of the Jew... Okay, carry on. You carry on. I'm going to get myself a little beer. You tell me what it says.
He talks about the font of wisdom titled Concerning Heresies, presented a series of discussions between Christians and Muslims. John claims that an Arian monk who he did not know was Bahriya influenced Muhammad and the right of view of Islamic doctrines as nothing more a hodgepodge cult from the Bible.
And?
Well, you'll have to read his full works. He hasn't got a link to the Christian site which I was on, which was the part of the Catholic Museum. It's online. You can find John of Damascus' work written there.
Yeah, but you said it has something to do with Muhammad.
Yeah, it does. He talks about in his letter about how he knew there was a prophet that came out of Saudi Arabia way, and he knew
where
of his...
In
his fucking letter!
It doesn't mention Muhammad.
I'm fed up with you, spam.
you and you left the truth gone. My goodness, no, this is the whole point. You cannot just take some propaganda and say this is what it mentions. You can't do that. Unbelievable. Why does he do that? Why does he believe this?
Sorry, I didn't hear anything. What was exactly the thing that you were talking about?
This GP was making the point that Muhammad existed and there are multiple references to him in various texts. And I said to him, no, there's not. And the first one is, for example, the Jacobi doctrine, and this is it's wrong and blah, 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 and it's much later, and so on and so forth. And then he comes up half an hour later and says, aha, I have the evidence, it's the Jacobi doctrine. I just told him it's wrong. And the thing is that nobody talks about Muhammad. And then he says, yeah, but there's this guy who's talking, John the whatever, and he's talking. I said, where does he mention Muhammad? No, you need to read it. I said, you came here and you said that you are talking about Muhammad. Where does it show Muhammad? And he says, well, and he left. Now, I've got a whole thing here. I wrote 32 pages on this. I've got here the Doctrina Jacobi, which is written somewhere between 634 and 40. Then we have Thomas the Presbyter. Then we have Saviors. Then, I mean, I have all these guys. I've looked at all of them. And they do not say anything about Muslims, Islam, Muhammad. And this is the problem. People, this is the same with Jesus. When people come to me and say, yeah, but Tacitus mentions Jesus. No, he doesn't. He's talking about Christianos. Yeah, but Josephus does. No, it's fake, because if you take the two paragraphs and you take the Testimonium Josephinum, and you will see it's fake. But you know, people don't do that. And if I've done all the research, if I've done all this, if I have everything in writing in front of me, and then somebody says, oh, but I have Tacitus. Oh, my God. That's irritating.
You were talking earlier about how Christians don't believe in Jesus, although they
No. I said they need Jesus for their belief, because Jesus is instrumental for Christianity.
But you were saying they somehow realize that it doesn't fit with reality.
Even if it doesn't match reality, they will still believe.
I'm sure. Surely most Christians actually do believe in Jesus. They do believe that that's reality.
Absolutely.
I thought you were saying they didn't. Reality.
No, it hasn't. No, it's today we know that it's not reality.
Well, most Christians wouldn't accept that.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Even if it contradicts reality, they will still believe it.
Well, yeah, but they don't think it contradicts reality. They think that reality.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
So for them, it's not contradicting reality.
No, for them not. And here I have St. John of Damascus. There's also the superstition of the Ishmaelites. There's nothing here about fucking Muhammad. Why can't people believe me? Unbelievable. Okay, anyway, whatever the case may be, maybe one day we should have a program where we will discuss the historicity of Muhammad or the historicity of Jesus, if you want. It's very easy. It's very straightforward. There's no black magic involved, nothing. You just go and look at the text, look at history. And this is why I'm thinking, maybe it's the right approach to handle Islam. Go look at history. Why is Muhammad not mentioned anywhere? Why are the six letters that he sent to all the neighboring countries where he offered them a treaty if they only convert to Muslim, why are they not found anywhere? Why is it that none of this that is being claimed in the text, why does none of this exist? And this is something that maybe we should go take a look at.
We should invite Tom Holland again. We can have a discussion with him about these things.
Does he? I don't know if he did anything. Maybe we should. Maybe let's see what he says about this.
I don't think he is as busy as some of the other guys. But I don't know.
I could try. Okay, so I don't think we've solved anything. I think we've opened more can of worms than we closed, and I don't think that there's any solution that we have managed to come up with. And I mean, I personally, I think we should just go and let Islam die the way that it's dying now. And this whole Reformation, I don't think, has a chance in hell, because it's exactly as you guys say. There's no way that they're going to accept that Muhammad didn't exist. They're not going to accept that the Quran is not the word of God, because that is the basis for Islam.
Well, that would be great if it were dying, but I'm not seeing that much evidence that it is dying. I mean, it's in terms of the figures of the people who at least say they're Muslim, I accept that there are probably a percentage of those who are too scared to say otherwise, but it's closing in on the biggest religion on earth.
Okay,
1.6 billion.
I see the opposite. I see that even in Saudi Arabia, there are now atheists which are openly atheists.
Really? Openly atheists? And then the religious police won't come and punish them?
Well, they are still doing it, but not all of them.
Saudi Arabia declared atheism as terrorism, so...
Yeah, terrorism, and then you could be executed for it.
You still get people. I mean, they had this like I said last week. They incarcerated the next guy now, where the religious police came and picked him up for making bad remarks or bad comments about Islam. But there are people who are now saying, the thing is they don't propagate it much. Okay, they don't go what is in the Quran. You see, if you leave the religion or you leave the ideology and you go and you fight against the Muslims, then you need to be dealt with. And then this is further specified in the Hadith where it says you have 3 days to think about this, blah, blah, blah. And if you don't do anything, then they don't care about you. This is the whole point.
What about the guy who had a blog post about Saudi Arabia perhaps becoming more liberal, and he got sentenced to like thousands of lashes?
Badawi, Saif Bad Badawi. Yeah, he's still in jail.
So, it doesn't seem like you're very free to go against the prevailing religious belief system in Saudi.
No, but there's more and more now. There's more and more people who are saying, I'm an atheist. There's more and more people saying, I'm an atheist, but I'm not going to go public and do anything about it. But there's more and more people saying, I am an atheist. And this is something that I saw when I was in Qatar, for example. In Qatar, there are so many people who are simply saying, look, I still go along with the flow, but I am no longer, I don't believe that this God exists.
I think these things that will reach a critical mass in the same way as it reached a critical mass in Europe.
Exactly.
And yep. Then it will be
acceptable. Exactly. Yeah. I agree with you. 100%. Yeah.
But then you've got the problem of the Muslim communities in Western countries, and they're often stronger and more pious and devout than the ones that you seem to be describing.
Yeah, and there you are 100% right. There the percentages are still climbing because of the influx and because there are still people converting. But then you don't get any numbers of the people in the UK where you see the YouTube video of them converting and they're saying the Shahada, and then 2 weeks later they think, oh, fuck, no, I'm not going to go there. Oh, shit, look at this woman, she's hot. Oh, I'm not allowed to, I'm Muslim. No. How many times do you get that?
Well, I'm not talking about converts. I'm talking about the 3 million people who are born into Islam in the UK.
And that as well, yes.
And that's doubled in the last 10 years.
Okay, and the people, and this is now the problem, because the people being born into Muslim, into Islam in the UK or in anywhere in Europe for that matter, they are the ones who are now leaving Islam the most, because they are the ones who realize the quickest that there's something afoot here.
And so why is the number of Muslims in the UK doubled in the last 10 years?
I don't believe it is.
It's gone from 1.5 million to 3 million.
Well, okay, how do you get those numbers?
It's the official figures. I don't know how they get them. It's probably the most recent census or something.
Okay, and there I maintain that this is not precise, because what the Pew Forum did, they asked people, and they came to completely different numbers. Because when you have anonymity, then you will say something different than when your family are watching and you are being supervised in the mosque, for example. Let's see what this is, redirecting you to the Muslim issue, John of Damascus, a false son of Muhammad is a forerunner to the Antichrist. Exactly, yeah. Okay, I think this has not been very successful overall.
Apparently, it's according to a detailed analysis by the Office for National Statistics.
Ah, okay. But like I say, it could be that at the moment you still get an increase there. Yes, but overall, overall, there's more and more people who are realizing that. The funny thing is that as people realize there's something wrong, some of them are not going the logical way of saying, well, let's abandon this then, but they're going the opposite way. And they're going more fundamentalist and more radical. This is the funny thing that I don't understand.
Apparently it's due to high birth rates and soaring immigration. Well, the EU would help to deal with the immigration issue, I think.
Yeah, but the high birth rate thing is a thing of the past. That is not true anymore for 10 years already.
Well, according to this article, it's that's part of what's caused the massive increase in Muslims in well, it just says England, actually, not the UK, although the large majority of them in the UK are in England.
Okay, there the data indicates that the birth rates are coming down to the same level as what non-Muslim countries are doing, or non-Muslims are having. So we're also in the 2.5 or something region. In Iran, it's actually very, very low. It's down to 1 point something, even lower than in France. So this is a thing of the past where I remember there were numbers in Mali, for example. It used to be eight kids per family, and those days are over. So anyway, so let's just call it a day, because I don't think we're going to get anywhere now discussing this without the real fact. If anybody wants to, you know, like collect facts and blah, 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 and come next week, this would be really great. Because a lot of times the stuff that I have looked at is now 2, 3, maybe sometimes even 4 or 5 years old. So if somebody has some updated facts there, that would be great. Anybody is welcome to voice their view if they come here with the facts, absolutely. So if somebody has numbers on that, brilliant. Ike, are you ready with the Hadith of the week? Because this is, we still have, because this is still along the lines of what the Quran says and what is being claimed as opposed to what the Hadith say. I can see something, but I don't know if this is now. There we go.
My software just crashed. Just a moment.
Oh, shit happens. Invite Saad, okay. The sad truth. Okay, so this is about fighting, all right?
This is what you will find in Sahih Muslim 20:4696. The Messenger of Allah said, "One who died but did not fight in the way of Allah, nor did he express his desire or determination for jihad, died the death of a hypocrite."
There you have reality. And then people say there is no compulsion, and it's totally peaceful. All right, ladies and gents, that was the Jinn&Tonic Show. Thank you very much for everybody. No, to everybody. Thank you very much to everybody for your contributions and everything. And I'm sorry that the GP had to rush out in a huff. That was not my intention. But then if you don't have the facts, I can't help it. We will meet again next week, I hope. If anybody wants to join next week, come to godless.ch. If you want to just simply discuss this here, just come in here, just type in hangout.godless.ch.
Just one last thing on the idea that Islam's dying. I'm just reading an article now. Egypt's justice minister has lost his job because he said that he would jail Prophet Muhammad, even the Prophet, if he broke the law. That cost him his job. Oh, yes. So if the people were abandoning Islam, wouldn't they just sort of shrug at that kind of comment?
No. That's a different thing. The one is recognizing reality, and one is being a religious nutjob or zealot. I don't think that the one excludes or precludes or whatever the other. I think it has a lot to do with reality, and I think it has a lot to do with what is happening at the moment in the religion, in the non-political side. I mean, come on, you do still have people being jailed for saying there is no God. Absolutely. In Saudi, for example, absolutely. No, they're not going to give up without a fight. But overall, I see that it's slowly going extinct because it simply does not fit into the 21st century, and people are realizing it. This is what I see. If not, well, then we just have to see. What is this? Thanks, Ike. See you next week. Jimmy, bye, everybody.